Good afternoon, everyone. Let me greet you all in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, our soon coming King. We have gathered this afternoon to pay tribute to a life well lived, that of Pastor Stanford Lewis. And as we seek to begin this afternoon, as close to when we announce we will start as possible, I invite you at this time to bow your hearts with me in prayer. Father, in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, we look to you, giving you thanks for your love and your mercies. Thank you for the opportunity to gather, to share, reflecting on what you would have allowed your Son to do in ministry here in Jamaica and in the United States, and that impact which you would have had on different parts of the world. We pray that as we gather today, that your Holy Spirit will comfort our hearts and bring that settled peace which we have relied upon from time to time as we've faced difficult situations. We put before you in a special way the members of his immediate family, that God, you will strengthen, you will provide that strength and peace to take them through these times. Bless us now and remember those who are also seeking to move physically from one place to the other in order to participate this afternoon. Cover them under your blood and let your will be done, we pray, through Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen. All right, good afternoon again, everyone, and good evening if you're at some other part of the island where, as it is now, it would be evening or night, and you may very well be at some place where it's morning. I want to thank you for choosing to join our reflection service this afternoon. And I trust that as we engage this afternoon, that even as we reflect on the life Pastor Lewis lived, that our hearts will warm. And there'll be that warmth as we reflect on, you know, this life. I'm going to ask that you can do a few things to at least be a part and to engage by typing in the chat, you know, just indicating where you are from so that at least family members who are on can also acknowledge your presence. There will be an opportunity for persons to share their tribute. We'll try to accommodate as many as possible. There are a few persons who have been identified from respective groups to give tributes, but there'll be an opportunity for everyone as best as possible to share within a specified time period. And so you can prepare yourselves also to do that. And again, just asking you just to indicate in the chat where you are from, so that at least other family members who may be on today can at least acknowledge you. As I prepare to facilitate this evening's session, the thought of Romans 10 and verse 15 came to mind. Verse 14 says, "How then can they call on the one they have not believed in? And how can they believe in the one of whom they have not heard? And how can they hear without someone preaching to them?" Verse 15 says, "And how can anyone preach unless they are sent? As it is written, how beautiful are the feet of those who bring good news." And as I think about Pastor Lewis and reflect, the thought of him having beautiful feet, as the scripture suggests, just comes to mind. And as we today come together, many of us would have been able to be touched by his life because of those feet and the journey those feet made in seeking to bring the good news of Jesus Christ to us, to others across Jamaica and in America. And I will not start by sharing the various memories but will provide you an opportunity to, you know, reflect and to begin your own expressions. But one thing I've contemplated over the period of his passing is, how did I, as a young man, come to be so affiliated with him, one, and to just have a love for him? And as I also reflect, this pastor used to give me a lot of trouble as a little boy. Everywhere he sees me, he would mock me with something that I would have said when I was even younger. But still, through it all, he would have impacted me so much that I would have had that deep love and connection with him. His warmth and just being around people, talking about him favorably. My probably keenest memory of him in the Jamaican church was when he was leaving and the celebration had for him at Golden Grove, and how persons would have spoken about him and all of that. It just warms my heart to know the life he lived and the impact he had. And I pray as we gather this afternoon, we'll be able to share together in those warm memories and thoughts as we reflect on the life of Pastor Stanford Lewis, and importantly, the sacrifice he made and that of his family, his dear wife, Sister Lewis, and his children. We extend our deepest condolences this afternoon, and we continue to pray their strength during this time. All right. I'm going to invite at this time, on behalf of the Church of God Seventh Day here in Jamaica, Pastor Harley to move a tribute at this time. He is the chairman of the executive board, and he'll be given the opportunity firstly to move his tribute at this time. Pastor Harley.
Thank you, Brother Sanjay. Let me first acknowledge you, moderator. I want to acknowledge the many ministers from far-flung places, United States, UK, Canada, Jamaica, who are online, other members of churches and ministers, officers of varying ranks, and ordinary members, whoever you are, please accept greetings in the wonderful name of Jesus Christ. I want to single out Pastor Nigel Lewis and other members of the Lewis family. And in my capacity as chairman of the executive board of the Church of God Seventh Day Jamaica Conference, convey our sincere condolences on the passing of Pastor Stanford Lewis, your father, husband, no doubt great grandfather, and the like. We are indeed saddened by his passing. We acknowledge that he was ill, and to that extent, one would have hoped that he would recover. He did not. But we are very, very grateful to God for the period of time that he was loaned to us on earth, and for the tremendous work and sacrifice, the worth of this man of God, whose life has left such a clear and indelible impression for good, for the glory of God, for ministry on so many of us. And I really am grateful and consider it a privilege to be able to share in this service honoring his memory and indicating to his family our deep appreciation for the work he did over the many years. I try to remember my first awareness of Pastor Lewis, and I found somewhere in the back of my mind an interesting memory. And that has to do with traveling on a country bus many, many years ago when I was very, very young. a bus called North Star. I don't know if anybody knows of that bus, but I was traveling on a route that was not necessarily my preferred route to Kingston and ended up on North Star. And there was this gentleman who came on. I don't think I was a member of the church then. I hardly think so. But this was this gentleman who came on. I think he was in a jacket and so on. And I think he conducted himself in such a way. I don't remember if he preached, but he conducted himself in such a way that he caught my attention. It was only after I came to the Church of God Seventh Day, became a member of it, and saw him in person that I realized that this was the man. And so in a way, I came in contact with him even before I came into the church. And you know, it's interesting that that memory came back to mind, because I also recall that in a time when I got into active ministry, in fact, when I was able to sit on the executive board of the Church of God Seventh Day, Pastor Stanford Lewis was then a sitting member and one of the persons who welcomed me on, even though I was a youngster then, and with whom I worked for many years. And I was even thinking that when the first concept of a finance committee on the executive board was raised, that Pastor Lewis, myself, and Pastor Alan Crawford, we were named to that. And I also recall fondly his various contributions, his preaching from time to time. And of course, everyone will, I no doubt, who knew Pastor Lewis will recall that he seldom had a sermon without his favorite song, Come Walk With Me. And that's a signal song. And I remember that as well. But I also found Pastor Lewis to have been a man of compassion. He was a man who really was what you call a pacifier, a peacemaker. He was a great encourager. He was somebody who would draw alongside you, and if you were irritated or upset, he had this calming, he had a winsome smile that he would come to you with. And with some kind words, he would encourage you, and you would feel that, you know, there is this person of value and worth who is genuinely interested in your well-being and was seeking to guide you in the path of righteousness. And that was something very special for me. I also recall, and many others will too, when attending convention, we would hear of his workload. And the famous account of the multitude of churches, and for there's no other word but multitude, of churches that he pastored and he would report on. And I feel in a very, very significant way that level of commitment to the cause of Christ and sacrificial service provides a kind of template and a background for many of us who have gone into ministry and have chosen to serve sacrificially. Because when we think of what Pastor Lewis did and how he did it, and his attitude towards the work, then it made us realize that what we were doing was not much compared to what someone who had gone before us had done. And I really am thankful to God for having met him and having, you know, come in the shadow of his ministry so that I could benefit from what it really means to be called to serve. And I remember in one of the conversations we had, Pastor Lewis would kind of tell me, I don't recall the account that well, but I remember this much, that he had a call or an opportunity to go to the United Kingdom. and he was making his plans to migrate. And somehow he was called into service in the Church of God someday. And, you know, he felt so committed to that call that he altered the plans to go away. And I know that that did not come lightly, because in the context of the Church of God someday, we did not have what to reward him and what to cause him to really consider the option of staying more beneficial than going. And so for me, that gave me a measure of the man he was and how he would, you know, make a decision that no doubt included a lot of sacrifice for the benefit of the work. I also want to thank God for his family, who would have provided him with the opportunity, though strenuous and challenging it was, for him to make himself available and to be such a reference point for ministry and service in the Church of God someday. And so again, we are grateful. The Church of God someday in Jamaica is grateful. As a conference, we thank God for him, for the mark he has left. And we pray that God will give his family the comfort, assurance, and the sense that truly his labor was greatly appreciated, and that in terms of how, you know, he lived his life, he may not have had a whole lot to contribute in terms of materially, but he made a huge spiritual contribution to the well-being of our church and to ministry in general and to young men who have grown up and become ministers themselves. Thank you for the opportunity. May God bless the family. And may God bless us all. Thank you, sir.
All right, thank you, Pastor Harley. Thank you. Sound and true words. And it was something, even as we prepared that written tribute for him, to find out the number of churches that he would have pastored. So if you are here from any one of his churches, just going to ask you to type the church you know Pastor Lewis is associated with. If you pastored your church, you can just indicate that church in the chat and represent for that church. Yes, so many different churches. And interestingly, how these many churches still collaborated and operated even with him. So probably seeing a church once per month or something like that. It's just amazing. To God be the glory, to God be the praise. I'm checking to see Pastor Brown is on. I know I'm seeing Sister Jean. I'm going to invite Pastor Brown, if he's on, to move his tribute now. And I'm asking him he's speaking on behalf of the ministerial council, but also in his personal capacity. So I'm inviting Pastor and Sister Brown to just provide their reflection at this time. Please have them.
Thank you very much, Brother Sanjay.
Mm-hmm. Yes, we're seeing and hearing
Well, I greet everyone online. I'm very grateful for this opportunity. And when I hear the name Pastor Lewis, it's something that's engraved or indelible in my mind. My very earliest meeting of Pastor Lewis was in the late 50s, maybe 58, 60 coming up, because I know he hailed from Long Road, where my aunt lived. And so I'd have gone there, and he would have been in the community. So I knew him then. But in later years, in the early 60s, mid-60s, maybe 63, 64, definitely 64 coming up, he came in the era of Darling Spring, Top Mountain. So his work was working out of Top Mountain between these two churches. He was made an evangelist. And he was very, very active. And the word evangelist, even when he became a pastor, his real work was an evangelist. He had such a commitment and dedication to the cause of souls. that he would go beyond measure. In his duties, he would travel for miles. You know where you come from, the Golden Grove, and he was there, and he would walk there and to other places where there's no transportation. For years, he didn't have a transport of his own, but he was always committed to service. And he would go between the different churches. He served at so many churches, the Derry, the Azard, the Rock Spring, you name them, Top Mountain, Darling Spring. He eventually spread his wing all around. And this wasn't because he just wanted things to do, but he was the man that if there was a need and there's nobody to do it, he would volunteer himself. He had a passion for souls. And so he ended up at one time, if I'm not mistaken, over 12 churches under his supervision. I became a member of the church in Darling Spring. In those days, as an evangelist, you were not permitted to do baptism. So he would preach in the people in the church, and then pastor like Festus Brown or Pastor Walker would come and to do the baptism for him. It wasn't until in 1965, I think, he was appointed a pastor. And then his first baptism would have been in April of that year, 1965. And fortunately, there were five of us in that baptism. And I was the first man he ever baptized in his life. I have that distinction. So I have very, very fond memory of this goodly man. We have traveled long and far. He has really been a mentor for me. And like I say, his passion for souls. He would go to one of his churches for a Sunday night service. And just coming out of that Sunday night service, he would announce service for tomorrow night. And that could go on for weeks. And coming out of that, many people were saved or responded to the gospel of Jesus. And that was just his natural way of ministering or serving. You know, sometimes we plan crusade. He does plan crusade, but many times it's spontaneous. And he would just start that night and it goes on and go much better. I am always reminded, because he was only my pastor, my friend. Is my confidant. You know, we could talk, and there are things that he would say. You know, there's one thing I learned from him, and I still apply it even today. He said to me, believe half of what you see and none of what you hear. Half of what you see and none of what you hear. And I have experienced that myself. People had told me things that they have seen me do, and I knew it wasn't near the truth. Right? And so I'm proving it on myself first, that it wasn't even near the truth that I can say, boy, it's near that what they said. But so I've learned that, not to jump to conclusion, not to accuse people of things that perhaps they're not even aware of. And so there's so many things I learned from this man. His kindness knew no boundary. He would go beyond the call of duty, and whatever he has, he'll give it to the last. And I don't think sometimes his very family would understand his generosity. And I can say that man had really been a good example. And he served, you know, to the best of his ability. He serves in the church. He served as vice chairman of the conference. He served as the chairman for convention on many occasions. He served as the chairman for the license and the credential committee for many years. He has served in many other capacities, like I said, several churches. But he's always giving and giving of himself, giving more than one would imagine. I grew up, as I've said, he was my first pastor and the last. All pastors are mine, but first host pastor and the last. Because I came up under his training. I was appointed a deacon, a and thereafter a pastor, and we had a very good relationship. He had distinguished himself as a pastor and as a leader. I remember the days when it comes to like a rally or anything like that, he was the most sought after person in his time. You know, he could make anybody have to pull the knot once they are there. He has a way of getting it out, though, you know. He was very, very distinguished in those areas. And when it comes to his presentation, his messages, he has a way of getting on your inside, searching you and sending the arrow straight to the inside. And he, when it's altar call time or so, his messages would be punctuated with a song, you know, with a careless soul, no heed the warning, or the old account was settled long ago, you know, but it has certain songs that will appeal to you. And there's no question about you really coming to the point where you'll make a commitment to the Lord. I'm very happy and much, you know, better off for the person I am because of this great man. And so I just want to, you know, say to the family and other brethren that we have lost a great man. He has really been a stalwart. On behalf of the License and Credential Committee, the Ministerial Council, I served with him on all these, and the Executive Board, I eventually came and served all on these ministries with him. And it's all because of the example he had set and the good relation we had. And so again, on behalf of all those ministries, I just want to say, you know, our sincere condolences to the bereaved family. And we're praying their strength that they will survive and be willing to meet him and be ready to meet him on the other side. God bless you and thank you very much.
I just wanted to add very briefly to the lighter side of Pastor Lewis. I always found him to be such a calm person. But then getting to know him and him being a family member through the association with Pastor Brown, then I knew he could be ruffled, but he had such dignity and calm about it. It was always something to admire. And also, I think all the trees, everywhere he has ministered, knows him. Because Pastor Lewis toots everybody. The horn was always going. So you had a feeling that nature itself was aware that this great man of God was passing through. Another lighter moment that I am aware of is that, you know, when you're having rallies and you say, Pastor, what time the rally started? When the people gathered. That was his time for starting a rally, when the people gathered. So, I mean, over the years through Pastor Brown, I've got to know this man and his family, and I've really fallen in love with him. He's a great example, lived a great life. And if all of us could just take a piece from his book, then I know all of us will make it to the kingdom. Fantastic man. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Pastor and Sister Brown, for sharing. Welcome, history lessons there, Pastor Brown. Such history, rich history too. Thank you so much. You wear the hat first, man, Pastor Lewis baptized. All right, very good. I'm gonna invite at this time Sister Olive Hanson just to minister in song. One of Pastor Lewis's favorite songs. We know it's his favorite because of how often he would have sung it. And I'm, as Sister Olive prepares to come, I'm seeing in the chat various churches, such as Spring Village, where he would have pastored, Top Mountain, Brooklyn Community Church, Hamwalk, Rock Spring, did I say Spring Village, Golden Grove, Brayton, Darling Spring, Hazard, And Long Road would have been one of them as well. And Beckford Crawl would have been another. Clarkstown, I think I saw that one in the chat as well. And one thing that seems to resonate is how many young people came to the Lord while he served. And that's just phenomenal. I think we have Sister Olive ready, and so I'm going to invite her to come forward at this time with her song. Sister Olive.
Good afternoon, everyone.
Good afternoon, sis.
God be the glory, great things he has done. Before I sing, I would like to offer sincere condolences on behalf of the Hansons and the Browns family to Pastor Lewis's family, church family, and friends. He was a wonderful man of God, preaching the word of God, and I know he had a passion for souls. And I always just love his voice. Had a beautiful voice and could speak really sweet, even at concerts and when he called. And, you know, I remember those good old days. I'm around a long time. I am young, but I've been around a long time. So I believe that he has many stars on his crown. And I don't think that we should be sad, really. We should be happy because he lived a full and a good life. You know, you can't get away from being a little, but he has lived a good life, and the best life, it's in the Lord. And so as I sing one of his favorite songs, I pray that it will be a blessing to each and everyone. A long life road, I stumbled in the darkness. My blinded eyes has caused my feet to roam. I met the Lord who spoke to me so sweetly. Come walk with me and I will see you home. Come walk with me, the road is straight and narrow. Come walk with me, you cannot walk alone. For the road is rough and there are many dangers. Come walk with me, and I will see you home. I listened to the blessed invitation. I asked the Lord if he would take me in. He said, repent and turn to me in prayer. And someday soon, I'll see you safely home. Come walk with me. The road is straight and narrow. Come walk with me, you cannot walk alone. The road is rough and there are many dangers. Come walk with me and I will see you home. So now I walk with Christ, my blessed Savior. I have no fear, for I am not alone. He guides me through this world with all its sorrows. And someday soon, He'll see me safely home. Everybody, please sing. Come walk with me. The road is straight and narrow. Come walk with me. You cannot walk alone. For the road is rough, and there are many, many dangers. Come walk with me, and I will lead you home. Come walk with me. The road is straight and narrow. Come walk with me. You cannot walk alone. For the road is rough, and there are many, many dangers. Come walk with me, and I will see you home.
Thank you so much, Sister Olive. Indeed, one of the favorites from Pastor Lewis is known for this song, as was shared earlier. Thank you so much for that beautiful singing. I'm going to be inviting Pastor Crawford, he's chairman of the British Conference. I know he's on, and it's after 10 going to 11 there in the UK, and I'm sure he is willing and would want to provide his own reflection. So if you are on and available now, Pastor Crawford, I'm gonna ask you to provide your reflection at this time.
Thank you very much, Brother Sanjay. Let me use this opportunity to extend greetings to all the brothers and sisters, Pastor Harley, all the other pastors on. I want to, in a very special way, acknowledge Sister Lewis and all the Lewis's family, and to offer on behalf of my family here our profound condolences on the passing of Pastor Lewis. I also hasten to offer condolences on behalf of the British Conference. And I would want to, in a very special way, offer condolence on behalf of Pastor Lipton Smith and family, who has had an acquaintance with Pastor Lewis over the many years, as the Smith's family hails from Top Mountain, where I know Pastor Lewis labored for many years. There are so many things I'd like to say about Pastor Lewis, and it's very difficult to find words to describe him, the man he was, and the man he had been throughout the many years and the lives he touched. I knew Pastor Lewis from a very tender age. As a matter of fact, at one time, I was a water boy for Pastor Lewis. And you won't understand why I said I was the water boy. As someone who was conceived in the church and got saved when I was 12, there are many persons in the Christian church who would not know that Pastor Lewis used to ride a bike, Triumph, one of those heavy bikes. And I always look forward to the times when Pastor Lewis would come to Crescent. He was very, very close and friend with my mom and the brethren there in Crescent. But not many people would have known that the first set of proper benches that the Crescent Church had was made by Pastor Lewis. So during the time when Pastor Lewis used to come to the Crescent Church to work on those benches, my mother would be the one who prepares his lunch. And then she would call me, come on, boy, take water to pastor. So I was one who was taking pastor's lunch as the boy and taking pastor's water. And there was never a time. And then I've always asked my mom, is he from foreign? Only because of his diction and the way he spoke. He made such an impression on you whenever he spoke. He was dignified. He was very committed to his Lord and committed to the work of the gospel. And as I grew, I wondered if Pastor Lewis was singled out to be given the churches in the most remote and difficult parts of the country, because it seemed to me that if there was ever churches that people were not willing to go, Pastor Lewis seemed to have been so willing to take on the challenge, and he was always willing to do his part. So he was so committed and dedicated to the task of building God's church, building God's kingdom. And so he never shirked at all from his responsibilities. But there's also something that we need to know about Pastor Lewis. As my sister shared with me tonight, that he had a love for what he was doing, that he was so careful and caring about the brethren. And so she reminded me about going to Darling Spring at some function once, and that it was late, and a group of them from Crescent had difficulty finding transport to get back to Crescent, or even to get to Bog Walk. And so she said, Pastor Lewis, what he did was he took his family, drove them to near where transport could be, left them, traveled back to Darling Spring in the night, and took them to Bog Walk, where they were able to get a transport to Crescent, and then he took his family and proceeded to Kingston. And so she was lamenting and saying to me that hardly in these times can you find someone that had such a caring heart and commitment to ensure the safety of the believers. I had the opportunity to work with Pastor Lewis when I served the Jamaica Conference on the executive board as conference secretary. And I can tell you that Pastor Lewis's contribution was such that it would have been hard to find someone to fill that post. Now, we all know about Stella. And for those of you who do not know who Stella was or what Stella is, Stella was the last car, that station wagon that Pastor Lewis would drive. And he was always up and down the country taking things to the brethren wherever they were. And so there were days when Pastor Lewis would be out going to the country, going to Rock Spring, going all about, and he would be giving of himself. He did not flinch. He was truly a man who knew what true religion was, to visit the fatherless and to care for those in need. Pastor Lewis had a wonderful sense of humor. It's not just the preaching and the singing, but if you were able to sit with him and to delve in some conversation, you'd realize that this man would make you laugh and laugh and laugh. And so I remember one day I was traveling with him from Kingston to Spanish Town in Stella. And he used to call me Rob. He said, Rob, You see all them things where you see before me, all them BMW and Lexus or whatever it is, if that was there at that time at Honda. They say, when me jump in a Stella, I know them can't follow me, you know, Rob. And he has this way of talking and laughing. He said, Rob, them can't follow me, you know, my son. If you are able to listen to him, and I see Sanjay laughing because Sanjay, of course, would have listened to him speaking in that way. So I was a bit concerned. And he said to me, Rob, them can't follow Stella, you know. No, because you see, are you saying to me that is how fast you're driving, Pastor Lewis? He said, Rob, them can't keep up to Stella. And I said, well, Pastor Lewis, you have to be very careful, you know, because mine speeding, mine accident, and mine the police. He said, Rob, you know, understand me, man. Me nearly killed them with smoke. So, in other words, Pastor Lewis was telling me that Stella was effective and Stella was pushing smoke. So all of the vehicles that were behind him kept back and allowed him to go, because they didn't want to be caught up in the smoke that was coming from Stella. So when I was there concerned about his speed and advising him to take it easy, he was saying to me, Rob, I nearly killed them with smoke. We had such a laugh that day. Pastor Lewis was one of a kind. Not to mention the admiration that I have always have for his family, Sister Lewis and the boys. I've always, and I did mention to him once that, you know, Pastor Lewis, I'm really so impressed and touched when I see your family and the life you live, the example you set. And so as he traveled, he always shared with me stories, some of the challenges. And I remember clearly Pastor Lewis reporting at one convention about a particular church that shall remain nameless, that he was pastoring. And he was saying how difficult it was. And he was asking the church to pray for him because, in his words, this church has become the seat of Satan. And the way he said it, you could not help but feel for him. But there's also another time when I must share with you, when I was taken to a church by Pastor Lewis to be installed as the pastor. This particular church had dwindled down to a very few members. So after the official installation, Pastor Lewis asked me to give the sermon. I gave the sermon and I spoke about David and Goliath and how when David said to Goliath, you come to me with a sword and a spear, but I come to you in the name of the Lord. And then I mentioned about Jehoshaphat, the battle is the Lord's. And after the sermon, Pastor Lewis took me outside. He took me under a tree. And when he saw the situation and the condition that he had just installed me, he shook his head. He said, my son, you preach a nice sermon, but only God can help you with this church. So when he said that to me, I said, Pastor Lewis, if you know it's so bad, why are you putting me here? He said, Rob, you have the answer. You said the Lord is able. Me only telling you the truth, my son. But do we pray for you? Pastor Lewis was indeed one of a kind. I will miss him. I will treasure his memories. I will treasure the encouragement. I will treasure the kind words that he has always given me. I will treasure the memory of a man who loved family, who loved God, who loved people, a man who had an infectious smile, a man who would make you feel uplifted whenever he speaks to you. And if it wasn't getting through to you through the words, it would get to you through his humor. I shared with my board in the UK the other day and shared with Pastor Lipton as we were contemplating some decisions. And a number of men were talking what we're going to do. And I had to stop and remind them. I say, hey, brothers, let me remind you what, let me tell you what Pastor Lewis told me. He said, Rob, if you bite off too much, you can't chew. And if you not bite off nothing, you can't chew. And I shared that with them, that Pastor Lewis told me this. And these are words that I always keep in my arsenal. These are words that I always consider when I'm making decisions and remind even my fellow ministers. Pastor Lewis said, if you bite off too much, you won't be able to chew it. So let's go gingerly. And so to Sister Lewis and the Lewis's family, you can be proud of the contribution that Pastor Stanford Lewis has made to the Church of God Seventh Day. You can be proud of the investment that he has made in our lives. You can be proud of everything that he stood for. And you can truly say, I will live the best way that I can live, so that when the earth is made new and Pastor Lewis shall come forth with all of the sayings, that you with ourselves will meet him on the other side. May you be comforted in this time of grief, and may you remember that you are not walking alone, because Jesus, of whom he always sang, is walking with you. May the Lord bless you. Amen.
Thank you so much, Pastor Crawford. Beautiful tribute and remembrance. Well appreciated. As I said earlier, I'll save some of the comments until you share. So Pastor Crawford brought in Stella into the picture. That's the car I knew, and I gather it may have been his only car. And not to mention Pastor Crawford called it his diction. That was a straight American accent, you know, that Pastor Lewis had, which I gather he may have gotten suddenly after his baptism, which is also an interesting fact. It was notable and remarkable how fluent he was, and I'm calling it that American accent and that laugh, which was so infectious. Thank you so much. Oh, I gather it's a British accent. All right. So thank you so much, Pastor Crawford. Well said and much appreciated. You made me laugh as you imitated him talking and laughing. It brought back so many wonderful memories. So again, for those who would have joined after, welcome. And we'll provide an opportunity later on for persons to share their tribute. Thank you so much for coming on today. You can indicate who you are, where you're from in the chat, so at least family members who are on can, you know, acknowledge your presence at some point. So thank you so much. I also want to say, unlike a regular service, we will not have many songs because we want as much of the time as possible to allow for you to express and to share your thoughts and remembrance. So please bear with us while we facilitate that and just celebrate the life of Pastor Stanford Lewis. Hibbert Hamilton is on. I'm gonna invite him to provide a tribute now. Pastor Hibbert Hamilton served our conference with Pastor Lewis in various capacities, like Pastor Brown and Pastor Crawford, Pastor Harley on the board and otherwise. I'm gonna invite him to share at this time, after which I'll be asking Pastor Dalkeith Moore to also share. So we'll have Pastor Hamilton now and then Pastor Moore.
Let me say greetings, first of all, to Pastor Harley and other board members, other ministers and officers of the Church of God Seventh Day, both in Jamaica and online. I want to thank God for this golden opportunity for these few minutes to propose a tribute to a man that I knew well over 60 odd years. In fact, I remember as a boy, my father was the pastor for Hazard Church, and I followed him to Dean Pen, where Pastor Walker was the pastor, but they were having I think it's a concert or rally. And I saw this man walking up and down, busy, and I asked my father, who is that? And he told me that it was this pastor or evangelist at that time, Lewis. And I even heard that he came into our body from another body. I don't know exactly how that worked out, but I was told that as well. That was in the year 1961. So from 1961 till now is also 61 years since I have known Pastor that we're talking about tonight, Pastor Lewis, that man. I did not see him again, and I had no interaction with him over a number of years until I went to Kingston to reside in 1965. At that point, I still wasn't saved yet, but I visited church every now and then at that time. When I got saved in late 1973, I began to see Pastor Lewis very often at North Street. In fact, I was baptized in the last baptism at North Street. And incidentally, I was the last person to baptize as well from the Church of God Seventh Day, because the last baptism and then Maxwell Avenue and so on. Pastor Lewis gradually became a very good friend of mine. I remember before the church was built at Maxwell Avenue, I had the opportunity of living at a house that was there before the church was built. And Pastor Lewis was not living too far from there, off Maxwell Avenue, further up. And he would visit so very often. I remember he went to do a funeral in Golden Grove on a Sunday. And Monday morning he came and he said to me, Brother Hamilton, I want you to go with me to Golden Grove this evening. Can you make it? And I considered, I told my wife, and we agreed, and I agreed. So we went the Monday night. It was a funeral, as Pastor Brown was saying early on, you know, impromptu things like that happened where Pastor Lewis was concerned. So I went with him, and he asked me to preach. I preached tonight. And while we were coming back home, he asked me to go back the Tuesday night. I went back. And eventually, we went the 5 nights for the week. And I wasn't feeling too bad because I wanted to preach as well. You know, an upcoming preacher, young and, you know, excited and want to deliver the word as far as, you know, the Lord will lead me and so on. And so Pastor Lewis and myself, we became very good friends. I thank God that I met this man very well. He knew what it is to be a friend. I found him to be a friend. I found him to be a confidant. I found him to be a counselor. I found him to be a teacher, a father. He was even a builder, because when I bought my house in Portmore, I asked him to do an extension to it, and he did it so well. It's still there and it's still working well. And it was Pastor Lewis's effort that helped. I don't have to go over a lot of things that Pastor Harley or Pastor Brown or Pastor Crawford went over, but Pastor Lewis was a different kind of person from a lot that we see around us today. And even in his time, because, you know, we would travel. I remember I had this half-ton BMC van, and a lot of the ministers in the church did not have motor vehicles at that time. So I was asked to take them, whether it's to St. Thomas, Portland, St. Mary, St. Elizabeth, not much in St. Elizabeth, but Montego Bay, Clarkstown, and wherever. I was the one who was asked very often to take them around. And I was feeling so good to be a part of that company. And I learned so much from the ministers, and my growth depended on what I've learned from them. And I tried to accept the good things and the good examples that I saw them setting for me. I felt so happy to know that I went on the executive board. I was invited or voted on the executive board in 1981. And from the tenure from 1981 to 1993, Pastor Lewis and myself worked together. For most of that time, he was a vice chairman. When I just went on the board in 1981, that then Pastor Madden was the chairman and Pastor Wallen was the vice chairman. And after Pastor Madden deceased, then Pastor Wallen became the chairman, and then Pastor Lewis became the vice chairman. Pastor Lewis could stand by himself. He doesn't need to agree with somebody else. He has a mind of his own. He had a mind to do whatever he thinks that is right. He was not afraid to talk about it, although it might change later on, because as a board, we have to agree on some point. But even if he has to shift, everybody knows what he's all about already. So Pastor Lewis had been a man, it's hard to forget him. It's hard to find any fault with him. Because even when he's going to correct you, he uses the word of God. The Bible says, if you are found with a fault, you who are spiritual, counsel such a one or correct such a one in the spirit of meekness. And that's what he did. And that's what he does. That's the kind of person. He's telling you the truth, but he's going to correct you and tell you you're wrong, but he's going to tell you the truth, and you have to love him. And so I find out that with associating with this gentleman, a Christian, a man of God, a good example, I had nothing contrary to say than what others have said, and even more than what others have said, because, you know, he was so dignified. He was so upright in everything. You have never seen him or heard him use any slandering word against anybody. In fact, if you hear somebody saying something about him, he would appear as if he doesn't even hear. He's not even careful whether somebody is saying something bad about him. And so I felt happy to know that I was so associated with this gentleman for many, many years. I recalled, as I said, he was a father, he was a confidant, and he was a friend. I recalled when they stole my van, he was the first one to find me. He came down to my workplace, and he consoled me. And when he was leaving, he folded his hand and put it into my hand. And, you know, it's hard to find somebody to do that, just to help me along the way. I remember another time, when my wife and I decided that each month we'll just buy a month of supplies from the wholesales, that Deacon Creed was doing business downtown. So I went to his business and I got all what we needed. Left the list in the morning, went back and picked it up. And the evening when I was ready to leave work, they broke into the van, took out everything, including my tools, and everything was gone, you know? And Pastor Lewis was the man again, came back to me the following day when he heard, you know, and he consoled me. And he, you know, he spoke to me so kindly. It's good that I have the Lord I got more of the Lord from what he said. And I was so happy to know that he was like a father. He was like a bigger brother. Want, you know, to shield me from saying or doing anything wrong. He would check me from time to time and find out how I'm doing, how I'm cooperating, how things are going at home, if things are okay. And you don't find anyone like that. And so this afternoon, I feel very happy to know that over 60 years ago, I met this brother, this gentleman, this father, this confidant, this empathizer, this man who he fulfilled the role of a leader, a child of God, one who leads God's children, and one who is not afraid to speak his mind because he's speaking from the word of God every time. And so I would just like to say on behalf of my family, and in particular my wife, you know, we are in our 50th year now of marriage, just a few months to 50 years. And although she's cognitively derailed, she's not able to say anything, but I know if she was able to, she would have wanted me to say thanks to the family of Pastor Lewis. And I join with the rest of my family to express condolence on behalf of this family, Hamilton's family, to the Lewis's family. And I just want to repeat a verse. I want you to remember that he's resting. Take heart. Revelation 14 and verse 13 says, "And I heard a voice from heaven saying unto me, write, blessed are the dead that die in the Lord. And from henceforth, yea, saith the Spirit, that they rest from their labor and their works do follow them." His work is following him. So you don't have anything to worry about. We're praying together. God bless you. God strengthen you. Keep heart. Live it up, because he is waiting the first resurrection. God bless you in Jesus' name.
All right. Thank you, Pastor Hamilton. We go now to Pastor Moore. Following Pastor Moore, we'll have a tribute from the Spring Village Church. Sister Missionary Mitchell will be doing that.
Thank you, Brother Sanjay, and thanks for the invitation to speak at this time. Let me say greetings to one and all, and also like to offer condolence to the Lewis family. And I want to brand Pastor Lewis this evening as an unusual man that he was. And I say that because after listening to all the foregone speakers, I can really echo what they're saying, and the sentiments are true. And what I'm also happy for, Brother Sanjay, is the rich history that we're getting this evening. I think we're being fed from these men, Pastor Brown, Pastor Hamilton, you know, Pastor Crawford, Pastor Harley, with some rich history, and I'm happy for that. So as you know, my association with Pastor Brown is really Golden Grove. And I saw Pastor Brown not only as a pastor for the Golden Grove Church, but the Golden Grove community. When this man was passing through, and I think Sister Jean alluded to it earlier, that when he was passing through, his horn was continued going. And so somebody told me some time ago that if he passed a goat on the way, he would say hello. Nobody would escape a hello from Pastor Lewis. I had some fun memories with him. One is, I remember one day my father, he was in his field, his yam field, and we were there roasting some yam. And I remember I saw Pastor Lewis walking by, and Pastor Lewis stopped and was speaking with my father. And Pastor Lewis spread something on the ground, sat down, and was eating the yam. Now, I saw this man, I mean, that I respect so much, sitting with us in our company. I felt elated just sitting with him and listening to him speak as he was talking about the Lord and talking about church and so on. I remember when I got saved, I was in a community youth group, and things weren't going so right. And I said, let me walk up to church one night. When I walked up there, I didn't hear his sermon. That night, I didn't hear him speak. But what I saw was that he was standing and he had a kneeling pad in his hand. And he said, Sister Moore's son, come and take this. And I went up, I took it, and I knelt down. And I think it was Pastor Brown who was talking earlier about his words. That those words were cutting through me like a knife. And somehow I felt tears flowing down and I was there crying. And he asked a question which he would always ask, do you want to follow the Lord? And my hand was raised. And since then, I've been following the Lord through the effort of Pastor Lewis. Pastor Lewis and I share some very special moments driving in his car from Golden Grove to Kingston. Now, if you have never done that and sat with him in that car, as Pastor Crawford described just now, I mean, it's amazing some of the stories that you would have heard from him, driving in that car, sitting down with him. Pastor Lewis would always tell me that Rolling Stone gather no moss, and that I should always stay at Golden Grove. Although I was visiting his other church in Hamwalk, of course, he would tell me to stay there and develop the way that he wanted me to develop, of course. Another thing that Pastor Lewis told me that I have held dear to me since, I remember we were at a convention sometime in Maxfield, and Pastor Lewis pulled me aside and said, listen to me, young man, when you come to this place, I want you to find the older brethren, those who seem lonely, forgotten, and you sit with them and talk with them. And I've practiced that ever since. Pastor Lewis taught me that. And ever since, I've developed a relationship with the elderly brethren who themselves have taught me a lot and have encouraged me to move on. I remember I wanted to preach like Pastor Lewis. I wanted to cry like him. I wanted to sing like him. Of course, I couldn't sing. And so I wanted to be Pastor Lewis. I wanted to emulate everything he had to put out. And for me, I tried to be like him because I said that, you know, he had something that I admired. Pastor Lewis, as I mentioned before, was a community person. Doesn't matter who you are. I learned of a story from a young miss from the community some time ago who told me she was standing at the window one night while Pastor Lewis was preaching, and the words hit her so hard that she ran home. I, of course, asked her, why didn't you run to the altar? But she ran home. She said she was afraid of him. I've seen for myself men standing, smoking, and Pastor Lewis would drive up and they put it out, and they would change their composure because Pastor Lewis was around. Pastor Lewis would tell me to push my shirt in my pants, to not eat on the road when I'm walking on the road. These are some of the things that he would tell us and drill into us as young people in Golden Grove. I remember, as Brother Sanjay mentioned, I remember the day when we had that function for him when he was leaving. For me, it was a very sad moment. It was very, very sad to see Pastor Lewis go. And many tears that day were cried at Golden Grove when Pastor Lewis was leaving. And of course, we're happy at this moment that, for me especially, I am extremely happy that one of his son, my good friend, Brother Nigel Lewis, has taken the reign and is now pastoring the church in New York. And I believe that would have made Pastor Lewis very proud that his own son would have taken the reign and is going forward with the message of Jesus Christ. I'm happy for that. Thank you again for the privilege for sharing. And again, condolences to the family. And as we continue to pray your strength, may God continue to bless you. Thank you.
All right. Thank you so much, Pastor Moore, for sharing. Now, you know, in the chat, the discussion continues as to what's the origin or the language of origin or the accent where it was from. So Kevin Lewis says, when Pastor Lewis went to England, they asked if he was American. And when he went to America, they asked if he was British. Now, what do we ask him when he's in Jamaica? You know, where did he get his accent from? LP in the chat says, I remember Pastor Lewis for his words, do not throw stones, throw sand. And he also said, fill your mouth with water if you do not want to say anything that you would regret. And she is praying and hoping that his soul will rest in peace. He sure lived a good life in the Lord. We're going to journey to Spring Village now, where we'll have that group, well, representing the Spring Village group, Missionary Mitchell, paying her tribute.
Good afternoon, Sanjay and the whole group. Let me say, representing Spring Village, I was here when Pastor Lewis came to pastor this church. It wasn't a very nice day for him, but he was who he is. He was a man, as I've already spoken about it, he's a man that can put any fire out without getting into trouble and get burned. He would put his own water on it, and at the end, the fire would out, and everybody would rejoice. I remember, I'm not going to go into much remembrance, but what sticks out in my mind is that when Crusade will be here and he would preach, and everybody almost want to come that night from the community when Pastor Lewis started to preach, because everybody loved him. I also remember our bride Stella. We had good movements with Stella. When we go from Bedford Crawl, but I remember one special night we were coming from Bedford Crawl and a crusade meeting. And Stella break down with both of us. And I don't remember exactly how we got home the night. If we had spent there, how we came home. I don't remember one thing about Stella or the car. But it was always Stella. I mean, if you're coming from Bedford Crawl to St. Catherine, Stella gonna burn some smoke, as rightly said. Smoke is gonna burn, because you know Stella was always giving trouble. But he's never gonna leave the Lord room. So, and he never leave us when that you can't reach home. He always go back, pick up Stella, and it was Stella again. So it was a good way of living with Pastor. I wouldn't mind having Pastor Lewis here and until now. But you see, the time came when I was to leave, and I sung for him that day when he was leaving, and it was tears. I remember convention as well. As I said, I want to get into it. It's too much. It's going to take up the evening, because I want to dedicate the song to him, to the fellow, his children, his wife, and to those that listen upon him. It says, when I wake up in glory, unto Jesus I sing redemption story. You shall sing him, blessed be he who had taught you to be free. When you wake up in glory, by and by, you shall go as you go some sweet day. Shall pass away, and my soul shall reach a better land, and my soul shall be free, as the host shall reveal that the eternal shall understand. when he saw that was what was happening and how I was telling him that I came home to be a part of the gospel, God has sent me home. He said, okay, I'm going to recommend you to be a missionary. He was the one who did it. May his soul, and I'm not saying may, his soul is resting in peace. And his and condolence, my condolence, and church here in Spring Village, condolences goes to the family, praying that they will live and be sober-minded at all times as their father, grandfather, and husband were. God bless you. Thank you.
Praise the Lord. Thank you so much, Missionary Mitchell, on behalf of the speaking on behalf of the Spring Village Church. Indeed, looking forward to that by and by. And interestingly, the comments in the chat, there's a question about Stella's whereabouts. And Brother Dean is suggesting that Stella is resting in peace, waiting on the sweet by and by. No, my crazy mind went on to think about a resurrection morning when things, you know, great possessions that would have labored for the Lord would rise. Imagine that. But we do have fond memories of Stella, and that will be a common thing going throughout. I do recall the bike that was before my time for sure. But we do remember Stella, and I even found the make of Stella. I didn't know there was such a make type of vehicle. All right, we're going to journey down under somewhat and invite Angela Kidd from New Zealand, given the time zone, to give her tribute now. And then we will have a tribute, I think, from Golden Grove / Hamwalk by Una Hamilton. And thereafter, we're going to be having a session for open tributes. This session, unfortunately, will be timed, not so that you would limit what you say, but to allow as many persons as possible the opportunity to share. And so, you know, you can prepare ahead what you desire to say within a 2-minute window. As many of you as possible, we want to provide that opportunity. Not everybody is bold enough to talk. You can put it in the chat as best as possible. We'll try to share those as well. So Sister Angela, if you raise your hand, I know you're on, but not sure. I'm not sure what you're on as. If you just use the raise hand so I can unmute you. Raise hand feature. I can unmute you so you can share. Sister
Neho. I like the J1 is.
The ace.
Everyone is.
Thank you. Sister Naomi says she was a passenger on the bike a couple of times. All right, Sister Naomi. All right, Sister Angela, over to you. You can unmute.
Can you hear me now?
Loud and clear. You can go ahead.
Okay, greetings from New Zealand. I'm actually very nervous in coming on this platform to say something about my dear, beloved spiritual father and pastor, Pastor Stanford Lewis. He taught me what true love is. He taught me how to love Jesus, why to love Jesus. And he allowed me to know the importance of giving my life to God completely, not holding back anything. Because as previous speakers spoken, when he speak, the word reaches your heart. So he spoke under the anointing of the Holy Spirit. And there was no way for you to turn, but to turn to God. And I'm giving God thanks that he has allow his servant to minister, and that I'm one of them that has surrendered to God as a result. I remember, there's so many memories of Pastor Lewis. I remember him saying to us as young believers, there were so many young people that got saved at the time, during my time. And he said to us as young people, he said, you need to stay in the word and read the Bible. You don't need to read any other book, because what they have written it from the Bible. So you read the Bible directly. And I remember somebody got a bit upset about that because they're saying, you know, you'll be narrow. You know, there's so many good writers out there. But what he was actually saying to us is that when we have that foundation of the word, then whatever else is written, we can understand and know, we can make the evaluation, what they've been saying. And just to make it quickly that Stella had served well, he had served, the family had served as well. And Stella would come and pick up Shereen, Moore, Kelly, and myself, I'm sure, to take us home with a jing bang to Golden Grove. He would pick us up for rallies, take us to Golden Grove to rally, and we journey back down with him at night. So we just give God thanks for him and his amazing, selfless serving that he did for the Lord. And I want to just thank the family as well that they have allowed him to minister to so many people, so many lives throughout the years. Thank you so much for this time. There's much more to say, but until then, my heart will go on singing. God bless you all.
Thank you so much for sharing, Sister Angela. God bless you too. Sister Una Hamilton, over to you at this time.
Good afternoon, everyone.
Good afternoon.
My memory goes right back to 1975, when Pastor Lewis came to Hamwalk. Hamwalk is where I'm from. So he was a builder, so he came there and he was building my grandmother's house. So he would stay by there, and then he started to evangelize. Although he was a pastor, he was a great evangelist, as was said by Pastor Brown. So when he came in the community, he was friendly, so he would have known everybody, the family from which you are from, and he would not have a problem communicating with anybody from the community. So he started talking to people, and then there was a basic school there, and he had Sabbath school right there. So he used to get the help from brethren from Golden Grove, Top Mountain. He coming there now, when he's coming for that purpose, you take the same, I don't know if it's the same North Star that Pastor Harley alluded to, but there's this North Star that used to run from Kingston to Anato Bay. So it used to come through Hamwalk. So in the days he would come up, that time he would stay for night meeting, and then in the mornings he would leave for on the magnet bus. One experience that's we had as young people was that this lady was going to market one morning, and there wasn't any handyman to lift the load. So the alternative was to leave her because nobody was there to put the load up, and it was raining. Pastor Lewis came out of the bus because he was already seated. He rolled his sleeve up and he took up the load and put it onto it, said, no, you can't leave her. How is she going to make her livelihood? And you know how she, or he was able to speak. And he said, I'll go and do it. And he came down, and then somebody else, because there was one who was on the top, but nobody was there to lift it from the ground. And he did it. And after doing that, his clothes was messed up. And the lady was saying, sir, how are you going to go to your wife in this condition? He said, that's all right. That's all right. And as a result of that, the lady and her household became members of his church because she used to go to church on Sunday. And so Pastor Lewis never knew, no work was too menial for him to do. And in the community, people respected him just like as was said there. And so he never had to make an altar call. When he was about to preach, or when he's preaching, he would use the situations that were existing in the community in our country. And that is what he used to preach the message, you know, quoting from scripture, something. And then people just start to run to the altar. So when he started Hamwalk Church, the first baptism was in 75 September, and he baptized 13 persons. And by June 76, another 12. By September, the same 76, another 9. And that is just how he was. He just knew how to get along with young people. So I remember one of his messages that he preached. He said, who is Jesus to you? Is he your cargo or your passengers? Some of you, when you go in the bus, you just start draw Jesus here, so there, so everywhere. You need to say something good about the church and be decent. As a young girl, you don't go and you just sit everywhere. No, that's not becoming of a young lady. You know, you have to be different. When you meet the Lord, the things he used to do, you don't do them anymore. So, you know, Pastor Lewis set he set an example. He was very exemplary. He did not say one thing and do the other thing. Another thing too, after he started driving, no matter how near you live, because I'm living in Golden Grove, I'm living just 2 minutes away from the church. And as early as I think I could go to church, I could not reach before Pastor Lewis. As early as you go, he would have been there. He never came as a guest. He is the pastor for the church, so he set that example. He spoke to us where that is concerned. Be punctual, you know. And you are coming to meet the Lord, you go early, you prepare your heart and you go. So he was never late. We had experience of him before. He used to drive when he used to take the bus. That time he would come late because he had challenges, but still. A night service, as I said earlier on, he would come, make provision, come up the night, leave the morning. And I wonder how Sister Lewis and the boys manage without him, because when it comes on to the work of the Lord, that is where his passion was. I remember some young men say they are not coming in the church, no matter how Pastor Lewis is preaching, because they said once they look at him, he was so convincing that they would have to come to the altar and surrender, and they were not ready. But when he sees them on the outside, he would relate to them nonetheless, and you'd have them coming in. So he stood up for what he believed in, and he encouraged us. He fathered us. He pastored us. He was to us as, you know, he never passed anybody on the way. Everybody in the community knew him, and he knew everybody. He could tell you from what family you are from. So, you know, you couldn't get around Pastor Lewis that way. He was a practical person, and that did not take from him his spiritual stand. May his soul rest in peace, and may the family find comfort knowing that he had lived a very good life. God bless you.
All right. Thank you so much, Sister Luna, for your tribute. Very well said. And again, as Pastor Moore said, more history lessons for us, how the Hamwalk Church started and so on. Very interesting. Now, I'm going to invite persons to use the raise hand feature if you desire to share. And just before we go to that, I did say we would have it now, but we're going to be having a tribute live from the Brayton Church. And because, you know, of the time, we're going to take the Brayton Church now, and then we will be moving to the open tribute. So you can just prepare yourselves by using the raise hand feature so we can see your indication and invite you at the appropriate time. Brayton, over to you.
Thank you very much, Brother Sanjay. On behalf of the Church of God Seventh Day in Brayton, the wider church family, those who had associated themselves with him over the period of time, we want to express our sincere condolences to his family and his wider church family. We were saddened to hear of the passing of Pastor Lewis, and we know that as a man of God, it's going to be one of the most difficult period for the Church of God Seventh Day, especially in Jamaica. I came to the Church of God Seventh Day in 1974, and there I met him going to convention and him attending the church in Spring Village when he was passing the church. He was certainly a very kind person and dutiful. He was one who was always looking out for young men to serve in ministry. And it was at a time like that when young men were very scarce, and we could rarely find them. But few young men were around, myself and others, and he encouraged me as he saw me as a potential person for ministry. He also recommended through other channels to become a deacon, and also later on to become a minister. I'd learned through his own effort and his love for the work of the Lord this whole matter of volunteerism. He was volunteering, he had volunteered his whole time in ministry because the financial resources weren't there at that time. And he was encouraging all of us coming up as young men to understand that we can do it even outside of finding financial resources. And so I listened to his advice as a senior pastor. And here am I today within the Church of God Seventh Day. He pastored the church in Britain. He was the second pastor when I came here. I'm now the third pastor of this church. And he had left footsteps or shoes that can hardly be filled in this church. He had set a standard, a very good standard, that the brethren would follow and that those who knew him would look up to him. And in it all, we are saying that we appreciate him very much. His words were kind, true, and he was a man who was a man to his word. And for that reason, we have missed him very much. The church community at Brayton can remember him in many, many ways. And without any reservation, we can say that he had fought a good fight, he had finished his course, and had kept the faith. On behalf of the church community, we want to say thanks to his family for lending him to us to be a pastor of this church. And the passing of Pastor Lewis would have touched deeply in the lives of many individuals. And so, may his soul rest in peace, and may light perpetual shine. Thank you.
We're holding for a selection from the church. I gather a group of members that Pastor Lewis baptized will be rendering an item. So while we wait for that, Brayton, you can just use the raise hand when you're ready for that. I see Shara in the chat saying, he taught me so much. A man of dignity, a principled man. I really love this man. He used to call me his daughter. And I think Pastor Crawford mentioned, or he would say, my son. And so I guess he took on everybody under his wings, and he just, he was a father to many. All right. Let me see, Brayton, you're ready at this time with your item. Sister Barbara Miller, just before you come, says, Pastor Lewis was my first pastor. He baptized me in the river in Golden Grove. I never saw a fault or flaw in him, and I absolutely revered and adored him. My condolences to the family, but I know that Pastor Lewis has gone to rest, and I'm looking forward to seeing him in the everlasting kingdom. All right, over to you now, Brayton. You'll have to unmute though. All right, just unmute again. I think I muted you accidentally.
Thank Amen. You.
So ready Amen. To
move. Are you hearing me now?
Amen.
Loud and clear.
Okay, yes, Pastor Lewis, he baptized me. And for most of the FYCers who were here at the time, as a matter of fact, everybody, there was no FYCer that was left untouched. And so we rejoice in his life and also in his death, because we know he is gone home to be with his Savior. We're just going to do this little song. It's a song that he used to sing a lot. As we know, he was a very good singer. All right. My heart can sing when I pause to remember a heartache here is but a stepping stone along a path that's winding always upward. This troubled world is not my final home. But until then, my heart will go singing. Until then, with joy I'll carry on. Until singing.
until then, with joy I carry on until the day my eyes beyond the city, until
rest in peace, Pastor. God bless.
Thank you so much, Brayton, Pastor Bill, and Hamiltons for that beautiful song and tribute. In another time and place, I will talk about Brother Homer in that capacity just now. But we give God thanks for the words of encouragement as we look ahead to that day when God calls us home. But invite Brother Chase Ricketts to give his tribute now, followed by Pastor Robert Hurd, and then Sister Naomi Smith, in that order.
Hi, everyone. Good evening. I want to bring greetings to the church. I want to acknowledge the executive board members led by Pastor Henry Harley. I want to acknowledge all the members and brethren, friends that are online. And I want to make special recognition, give special recognition to the Lewis family, the bereaved family and friends. We just want to acknowledge a wonderful man, a wonderful leader, a wonderful friend that has left us. And we want to express, I want to express condolences on behalf of my family, the Ricketts family, to the Berry family and friends. I want to also acknowledge the brethren at Spring Village that are online as well. I will be real brief. I speak as one from the younger generation that Pastor Lewis has impacted our lives. I'll say this much, that when Pastor Lewis came to Spring Village, one would believe that we were just coming out of an election, but he possessed such calm in his deportment. He was such a wonderful man. He was such a calm person. I never see Pastor Lewis lose his cool. Maybe others have seen it, but I've never been fortunate to see it. He's just been in charge or in control, you know, of his emotions or whatever situation that he is in. He was a wonderful man. And I'll tell you this much, being a boy when Pastor Lewis came to Spring Village, most times during the sermon, I would be either playing with my friends, doing artwork, a piece of drawing on a piece of paper in church or something to that matter. But when Pastor Lewis came to Spring Village, without saying a word, much to any specific thing, he was such a charismatic individual. You were just drawn to follow him. I didn't even know the word charisma at that time as a boy. You know, one thing I knew is that I used to go outside a lot and I would play with my friends during the preaching message because, you know, being a child, I'm not sure how much it was impacted me or I was understanding. But one thing I soon found out very early is that when Pastor Lewis is at church, if you're outside, you're going to miss the joke. You're going to miss the humor. You're going to miss something. Because being outside, you only hear the entire church laughing. And then you start running inside. And by the time you got there, the joke was over. And so Pastor Lewis was the one that really kept me sitting in church during the sermons. You know, children used to or can't complain that, you know, sermons can be a bit long and boring. But when Pastor Lewis came to Spring Village, just his tact, humor, charisma,
and his eloquence. Oh my God. I was like, what a nice man. He's so soft and well-spoken. I don't know how he did it, you know, but it was amazing. And so Pastor Lewis would use a lot of humor in his sermons. And some of them, you know, I was able to use them as a way out, you know, in time of trouble. So he really saved me from a lot, right? I recall Pastor Lewis, you know, when I ran inside one day, Pastor Lewis was sharing a sermon and he used humor, you know, and in his sermon, he made reference to the Sunday Gleaner and reference to the advertisement page, you know, the advertisement page. I don't know if it's still in the Sunday Gleaner with the cow at the heading of the advertisement, you know, the bull and the bull's head, you know, and the bull's body at both ends of the title page of the advertisement. So while Pastor Lewis was preaching, he said, you know, a young boy was picture reading one day and his father came over to him and said, son, what are you reading? The little boy was looking in the gleaner and the little boy was so quick on his feet. He said to his father, when you look in the gleaner, I saw the bull, the bull on the advertisement page. The boy said to his father, Bucky, Bruisey, Cow, Calf, Kick and Prancy. That was what Pastor Lewis shared in his sermon. And it really got our attention. So I borrowed that line whilst I was growing up. If my sister was, or my sisters were teaching me, and I was asked to read something that created some challenge, to have a nice breaker in my mouth or an excuse, I would say, Bucky, Bruisey, Cow, Calf, Kick and Prancy. You know, so Pastor Lewis was that type of person. You know, he was very charismatic. Whenever Stella drove through the gates at Spring Village, I don't know where he got so much jackfruit from. But once Stella drove in, it's as though you're smelling jackfruit in church right away, you know. And he had such an infectious personality, wonderful children, Niger. I don't want to leave out anybody, but I'll just say, especially when Dino drive the van to church, filled with the children, oh my goodness, it was a wonderful, wonderful time. And we just want to recognize the impact that he has had on our lives. I'll tell you personally, since that time, without realizing, I was staying in church during the preaching sermons, and the word had an effect on my life, and today it still has an effect on my life. May his soul rest in peace. And the light of God continually shine on him. And to the bereaved family and friends, may the Lord continue to hold you in his arms and keep you and grant you his strength. Because the process of grieving, it's not easy to deal with, and it will take time. May the Lord bless us all in Jesus' name.
All right, thank you, Evangelist Ricketts, for your tribute. I'm going to invite Pastor Hurd and Sister Smith thereafter. I will not necessarily come on, so I'll just unmute afterwards. All right, Sister Smith, go ahead, Pastor Hurd.
Blessings. Greetings to all the pastors and the presbyter dignitaries across the globe. Let me say thank you for this opportunity and privilege to say a word. Especially greetings to Sister Lewis and her sons, Pastor Nigel and all the others. Grace and peace to the family from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. I am truly sorry for your loss, and share in the sorrowing and hurting season across the family. The scripture declares, and I heard a voice from heaven saying, write, blessed are the dead which die in the Lord from henceforth, yea, saith the Spirit, that they may rest from their labors and their works do follow them. And I say in this that when we talk about their labors here, I don't think that in the case of Pastor Lewis, we're talking about hard labor, because I believe that it was his joy. Everything that he did was his joy. Pastor Brown, Pastor Claude Brown, went back in the history. Pastor Hamilton said a little bit. I want to go back a little bit to when I was a kid, a child. I hail from Longwood. And I want to mention Pastor Lewis this evening as a peacemaker who is an example. Something happened in church. I was a child then. I don't even know what it was. But my mother was upset with another sister. That Sabbath, we didn't go to church. And whether it was planned or not, I don't know, because we didn't have phones in those days for anyone to call or on anybody. But I suspect that Pastor Lewis was in church that Sabbath, and we were missing. And he came. His brother lived not far from us. So he came to see his brother, but before he stopped, he actually passed Trumpeter's house, came down to where we lived to see my mom. Waited for her to come from the bush and counseled and make peace so that the following Sabbath, we were in church. And my mother and that sister became best of friends. When we talk about pastors in the church and we talk about making peace, it is not about judgment, but it's about using the word of God to allow individuals to understand where they are wrong and where we need to embrace the word of God. Pastor Lewis was not just a pastor. He was a father. In fact, I would say he was a father to every member of the church, especially to me. Now I spend many evenings out when he lived up there on Maxwell Avenue. He was one of the kindest pastors that I know. I used to think of him as a rich man. And I won't go into why I'm telling you that, but I used to think of Pastor Lewis as a rich man. I look back at it now and I realize that he gave out of nothing. He was certainly a pastor of pastors. Let me move very quickly. I grew up and I left Jamaica. I came to Canada in 1977. And for 2 years, I attended one church. And for 2 years, I took Lord's Supper at another church. For the simple reason that they did not do the supper the way I was acquainted with taking the Lord's Supper when I was in Jamaica. Pastor Lewis, I think it was could have been 79 or 80 that he came to Canada. And he was staying up in Markham with Sister Martin, and I found myself up there to talk to him about that the matter of the Lord's Supper. And he counseled me, allow me to realize the importance of taking the Lord's Supper and that I did not need to go elsewhere, because where the Lord plants you, he wants for you to grow there. And so from that counseling, I was able to take the Lord's Supper at the church I attended. A man that is full of wisdom. when it came to the word of God, he does not pull any punch. And you would think when he preaches and you hear him preach, you would think, oh my goodness, I don't want to be close to him or anything like that. But when he is off the podium and you start to relate with Pastor Lewis, you get to realize just how awesome and wonderful he is. Pastor Lewis taught me a lot of lessons that I can't even go into. I did not grow up with a father. I saw him as a father. I saw in Pastor Lewis how you ought to behave when it came to your wife, when it came to your children. He was just awesome. And I want to give thanks to God, our Father, and the Lord Jesus Christ for the privilege that he has given unto me, that he has allowed Pastor Lewis to touch my life. I could say a lot more, but I just want to say this. I pray the peace and comfort of God, our Father, and the Lord Jesus Christ to be with the family, that his protection and his favor be with you, that you will experience his anointing and his favor, just as if Pastor Lewis is right there with you. God bless you. And this goes to the family and to the church family. God bless you all and thank you.
Good evening, everyone. This is Sister Naomi Smith. I don't even know where to begin because Pastor Lewis and myself, we went back, I mean, long time ago, even before some of you were even born. I remember Pastor Lewis, he came to Top Mountain long before, but my father went away in 1961 to England. And my mom and my brothers and sisters were home, and Pastor Lewis would always come around to see how we were doing. And we looked up to him because he was such, at that time we were small, so he looked so tall. He was tall, spoke eloquently and everything. And when we were growing up, as we know Jamaicans speak patois, we as well couldn't speak patois because my mom would not allow it. We had to speak proper English according to her. And Pastor Lewis was always around us. He would come to find us how we were doing, how mommy was doing because daddy went away and things like that. He used to give us jokes and we admired him for how he used to carry himself. We went way back. And I remember I was born and grown in the church, but then we weren't saved. We thought we were Christians because we would fight for our church if anybody said anything about our church. And I remember my brother went out the street one time and somebody was talking about our church, Top Mountain, because it was just some blocks with some board, you know, for seat where you put the blocks, the board and the seat. And the other church was like Presbyterian and big church, and they were talking about our church. And I mean, my brother defended our church by fight them. And when Pastor Lewis heard that, he said, no, that's not how you fight for the Lord. You don't fight in the church. And he took it as a joke, you know, and he encouraged my brother and told him not like that. Pastor Lewis had a crusade, I remember it. And 15 of us, at this time my father left, and Pastor Wallin was a pastor, and Pastor and Evangelist Lewis came and had a crusade, and 15 young people, 15 of us got baptized that time. He wasn't able to baptize us, yes, but he walked us in the water and gave us off to Pastor Wallin, and we were baptized. And I'm telling you, that man, I don't know, we were friends from then because Sister Blas, Apostle Lewis's wife, we grew up together, so we were friends as well. I remember going to their weddings in our little pink dresses. And so, you know, it's way back. So he was a man, he wouldn't allow us to feel as if, even if we did something wrong, he was so kind. The way he reacted with us and the way he corrected us. I remember one time somebody said something about me and tell a lie, which was a lie. And we were so upset because when we went to the person stood before our face and said, yes. So he called us and he took all of us as young people and he said, never. Don't even, you know you didn't do it. You say you didn't do it. If they decide to tell a lie on you, they are going to say yes even before your face. So do not, because he was giving us an example when he was going to Long Road one time, and he in the night, and he heard somebody pass, like a dog or something. He didn't see anybody because it was dark, because you know we had to light the tilly lamp those days. And he said when he went to church, he saw the church people coming, going home. They closed the church and was going home. So he said to them, where are you going? I'm coming. He said, this little boy just come to church and tell us that he saw you down the road. And he said to tell us no church is keeping. And he said, I didn't see any little boy. I heard something, somebody passed me, but I didn't see any. And when Pastor called, he said, when he called the little boy stood before his face and said, yes, you tell me that. So he was telling us, no, you see, what can I do? He said, he just look at him and pat him in the head and say, maybe you're hearing things, little man. He knew he was wrong, yet still he didn't chastise him. You know, he was jovial. He was such a good friend of mine. When we left Top Mountain after we left and I went to Riversdale to live, and he picked me up one morning, we were going to church at Top Mountain. He picked me up from Riversdale going up to Top Mountain. At that time, I got married and my name was Lewis. So we went by somebody and somebody stayed on the hill and said, Pastor Lewis, you're going to church, sir? And he said, yes. He said, is Sister Lewis with you? He said, yes. So we went to church and the person came to church and said, Pastor Lewis, you know, you lied to me, sir. You said Sister Lewis was with you. He said, I didn't lie to you. You asked me if Sister Lewis was with me. I said, yes. Isn't this Sister Lewis? You didn't ask me if my wife is with me. So he was so jovial. He gave so much joke, you know. I remember again, we were in Kingston when I was going to college, teacher's college. I went to his house to shop. You know, we're living on campus. You know, sometimes run out of things. I would go down to Sister Blas and Pastor Lewis's house and shop. Out the fridge and out the cupboard to go back to college. And he would bring things up for me. And I'm telling you, I admire that man. And we moved from there and moved to America where we were friends the same way. And one of the songs I remember him singing is, what was it? You Never Mention Him to Me. That was one of the songs. I really can't sing anymore right now. So I'm going to ask Brother Sanjay to allow my brother, Pastor Smith in London, to sing that song for me. He's waiting. So Sister Blas and the family, you know, God is always with you. And we are here for you. God is going to take care of you. And Pastor Louis said, no. By surety, we are going to meet him when the trumpet sounds. God bless you.
Go ahead, Pastor Smith.
Let me greet you all to all. Greetings in Jesus' name. Sister Smith has spoken, and hoping that my short verse to you might just say a little bit about Pastor Lewis. He was one of the persons I wanted was to get away from. And there were three persons whom I was a little bit reserved about staying around, and that was Pastor Lewis, God, and my mother. There were people.
Just a second. I accidentally closed your video. You can open it again. Sorry about that, and continue.
Right. Yeah. Three persons I was very frightened of was Pastor Lewis, my mom, and God. You see, Pastor Lewis, he came to Turn Mountain. When he preached, he was so penetrating. Even though I was young, Pastor Brown got converted, and I thought Pastor Brown was kind of crazy at that young age, because we were about in the same age group. But because of the strictness of my parents and the way we were brought up, I was hoping and wanting to be a bad man in a way, and I needed to have my way. And around those times, I wasn't too happy. I left, I came to England when I was 15 years old. And when I got here, a lady by the name of Evangelist Duncan preached a sermon, and it just as our Pastor Lewis would have preached, she daggered my heart, and I didn't get to be the bad man that I wanted to be. So God took me off in a very early stage. And one of the songs I remembered Pastor Lewis sang as well, as Sister Naomi said, you never mentioned him to me, and I'm going to endeavor to sing a few verses of that. He said, when in the better land, before the bar we stand, how deeply grieved our souls will be. If any lost one there should cry in deep despair, you never mention him to me. You never mention him to me. You helped me not the light to see. You met me day by day and knew I was astray, yet never mentioned him to me. Spread the word where hell it may be heard. Help grouping souls alight to see that yonder none may say, you showed me not the way. You never mentioned him to me. You never mentioned him to me. You helped me not the light to see. You met me day by day and knew I was astray, yet never mentioned him to me. A few sweet words may guide a lost one to his side, or turn sad eyes to Calvary.
So work as days go by, that yonder none may cry, you never mention him to me. You never mention him to me. You helped me not the light to see. You met me day by day and knew I was astray, yet never mentioned him to me. I'm very thankful that this song was taught to me by Pastor Lewis, and the way in which he spoke the words of God, when he spoke from the pulpit and these words got to you, the onus was placed on us, because he was suggesting that whilst he told us or as expounded the words to us, we had no excuse. And that's how I got to learn this song, knowing that the responsibility was on me. And thank God for the long time, the short communications that I might have had with him, they have been rather meaningful. And I thank God to have met him and for the guidance that he had given over the years that I knew him and was communicating with him. Thank you very much. And I offer my sincere condolences to Sister Lewis and the rest of the family. I'm sure Sister Lewis will possibly remember me. I'm not sure about his children, Nigel, and the rest. I've seen them, possibly met them too. But I'm hoping that God will continue to bless them in this sad time. I am one who believes that sadness will come and your tears will roll. I would say, don't allow anybody to tell you that you shouldn't cry or won't be broken, because this is not the easiest thing to have lost someone who you have loved over the long years. So may God bless you as you remain cheerful, knowing that God will keep his promises to you and to Pastor Lewis. Him being faithful will receive a crown of life. God bless you. As I say, good night.
All right. Thank you. Thank you so much, Pastor Smith, Sister Naomi, Pastor Hurd, for sharing those tributes, you know, and identifying Sister Lewis as Sister Bloss. That's something I didn't know. If you have any nicknames for Dean and Nigel and the others, you know, we can put it in the chat. We love to learn it. I'm sure there are persons on who would appreciate hearing some of those. I'm going to take, yes, I see Brother Nigel responding quickly. No, don't. All right. So we know there's some feather there to ruffle. All right. But we're going to take at this time Linval, Ford, and Shara. And please just keep it within a reasonable time of 3 to 5 minutes, please, so that others can also participate and share as well. Go ahead, Linval.
Good night, everyone. I hope you're hearing me.
Yes, we're hearing you. Can't go ahead.
Oh, yes. Good night, everyone. My name is Linval Brown, Sister Lewis's brother. I moved in with Sister Lewis and Pastor Lewis when I was a 17-year-old youngster. I lived with them for over 10 years, and in that time, I did everything around them. I went to church. I participated in the Friday evening devotion. We worked together. We drove together. We ate together, everything. And I was very impressed with Pastor Lewis, because I found him to be a very good example of a Christian person. And I was really impressed with that. And because of that, it was very easy to observe his house rules and everything. I knew I had to be there on Fridays for the devotion, and I made sure I was there. I tried my best not to do anything that would cause him any embarrassment as a pastor in the church, because I was so impressed with him. I really was. And you know, over the years, we developed a very good relationship. And even after I got married and left, we still used to chat on the phone a lot and, you know, just used to keep in touch and everything. And, you know, I really enjoyed being around him. I was not uncomfortable at all. And, you know, one of the things that impressed me about him was I said to myself one day that if I had 7 sons already, and my wife asked me to take her brother to live with us, which would make 8 boys in the house, I probably would be afraid. I'm not quite sure I could do it. I'm saying this is somebody special because he did allow me to come in and we were able to live as a family for all those years. And I was really impressed with him for that. And in closing, since I can't be long, I'm going to say to you all that another conclusion I drew of him was that I thought that he was the best example of a Christian person that I met in all my life. And I do think I still believe that. I was really impressed with him. And so that's all I have to say right now. And I thank you all for allowing me this time to say my piece. Thank you all.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'd just like to share briefly. I remember Pastor Lewis as a little girl attending convention at Maxfield Avenue.
Okay, just before you continue, could you just identify yourself? So
I'm Charmaine Ricketts Ford from the BCC Church of God, Seventh Day in New York. Okay.
Thank you.
Yes, so I admired his accent so much. Oh. And I remember as a child, I was curious. So I asked my grandmother, my grandmother, my grandfather, Pastor and Sister Jeffrey, where he was from. Of course, they totally ignored me. So I had to, you know, come up with my own conclusion. My grandparents had so much respect for Pastor Lewis and they spoke highly of him. And based on their stories, you know, I grew to admire him so much. Then when I migrated to the United States and saw him at Brooklyn Community, I was happy. I knew right away that the church was in good hands. I enjoyed the time, you know, I spent under his pastoral care at BCC. He was a wise pastor who approached issues with diplomacy, and I admire that a lot. He was everything that everyone before me mentioned, a great person with a wicked sense of humor. He was, as I mentioned before, he was a wonderful pastor and the epitome of a good shepherd. He was actually in the pool with Pastor Esben Rose when I was baptized. And while I was collecting information for the church history, I remember I spoke to Pastor Rose and he had fond memories of Pastor Lewis. He even mentioned that no one could, you know, do an altar call like Pastor Lewis. And when I was going through the records last week, I saw that while he was at BCC, he baptized so many. I shared that with Pastor Nigel today. When he became ill and he could not attend church, Sister Gladys Ling and myself and other members of the church would visit him at home to sing and pray with him. And despite the fact that he was ill and he still had that sense of humor that we all come to know. And sometimes we'd sit there talking to ourselves, thinking that he was asleep, and we would be surprised, you know, to hear him, you know, making some little funny comments. We thought that he was playing Brother Nancy with us. So, you know, we would laugh, and I enjoyed those days and I missed them. So I remember, you know, during the pandemic, I was saddened that we could not continue our visits. It broke my heart when I thought about him not having his brethren and friends visiting and singing and praying and keeping his company. However, the church continued to pray and we prayed on his behalf, knowing that our Father was there to comfort him. Pastor Lewis was a stalwart. He was eloquent, charismatic, compassionate, diplomatic. He was disciplined, caring. He was just a decent man of God. Thank God for him. And thanks to his family for allowing him to do what he did, that's blessing the lives of so many people and bringing them to Christ. And I know that if we continue to be faithful, we will see him again on that great getting up morning.
You can go ahead, Cheryl.
Good afternoon, everyone. You hearing me?
We're hearing you.
Yeah. Okay. I have so much memories of Pastor Lewis. I remember when I was to get married, I didn't understand much, and I remember him talking to me and telling me that he used to give me that accent. And so my daughter, you could come in and we could talk. Like, I used to go to the church like 2 times a week. And I remember buying, I would stop and buy Patty and little juice, and him would sit down and, he would coach me about getting married. And I remember one time I have that so it always in my head that he told me that, remember, when you get married, it's not going to be a bed of roses. There's times when teeth and tongue is going to meet, but this is what you got to do. Always remember that a soft answer turned away wrath. And I remember a particular time, again, when I was close to getting married, I told him that I want to invite the entire church, and he gave me that accent, and he said, go ahead, my daughter. And I listened to him, and I did it, and to God be the glory, everything went well. And he's the one that baptized me, and he's the one that officiated my wedding. And I must say, he's a man of dignity. He's such a manly man. He's such a man of principle. And he's a no-nonsense person. He's not going to sugarcoat, no lies. He's just a real man of God. And I remember one particular time when I went to visit him, me and my husband, and Sister Louise tell him that Shara was here. He gets so excited. And I remember when it was like about 8:30, and we was there cuddling. I feel like a child cuddling with their dad. We was cuddling on the couch, and Sister Louise kept telling him, Reg, it's time for bed. And he was like, leave me alone. I'm with my daughter. Leave me alone. And he didn't want to go to sleep. He was just so excited. And my husband was, come on, why are you cuddling? It's time for him to for his bedtime. And it was just that man. He taught me so much. I shared so much stuff with him, so much personal stuff. There's something I remember one time I was going through something so deep, and he's working out so well. He's like more than a dad. My dad passed. I never have that moment that I have with him, with my dad, and we shared a lot of personal stuff. And he's just, I feel good when I'm around him. Even on Sundays, when going to Sunday evening church, it was not much of us, but I was just so excited, like a little kid in a candy store, to go to church, because I felt going to church, you felt that love, you felt it was just so different. There's something really special about him. It was just like about 7 of us in church, but that man is really a true man of God. And I hope he rests in peace. My condolences to Sister Lewis and all the family members. I really loved him, and I felt so bad. I relocated to Florida, and I felt bad when Sister Lewis said, I can't believe you're not going to see Reg before you leave. And I said, because of the pandemic, I didn't want to go in and visit him at the nursing home. And I felt so bad when I was in Jamaica. I heard that he passed, and I felt really bad. I didn't go and see him. May his soul rest in peace.
Right. Thank you so much for sharing, Shara. Sister Ford and Brother Linval, thank you for sharing your tributes. And, we take comfort in that while you were able to, in other times, Shara, you would have shared with him, and those cuddles are precious based on your own expression, indeed. It's just a unique thing with visiting Pastor Lewis and Sister Bloss, Regan Bloss, as they share their own jokes. And like, as an outsider coming in, if you don't understand them, you would think, boy, what is wrong with these people? But spending time with them, you've come to appreciate that that's their fun way of keeping things together. And, you know, for me, as Shara spoke, one of my favorite times was being in his presence while at home. And I remember one time visiting him as she spoke as well. And you thought he was sleeping. And we were there just talking and talking. And out of the blue, here comes this question about, wait, how is Poogie doing? That's a name that, I mean, only persons familiar with my father know him by that name. Just out of the blue like that. He just had this beautiful sense of humor that kept us really laughing. And I see Kevin mentioning his sincere sense of humor was the most disarming trait. We're going to have a video tribute now from the Golden Grove Church. From the Moors, celebrating the legacy of Pastor Lewis, and following which, I'm going to invite Pastor Francis and Sister Francis to share their tribute.
Greetings, everyone. My name is Audrine Moore from the Golden Grove Church. And with me today are
Gertrude Moore, Shereen Moore Kelly,
and we are proud to be sharing in this reflection on Pastor Lewis as we celebrate his legacy in the Golden Grove Church and all the other churches that he has served. A wonderful human being.
Tell the prodigal boy, tell him to come without delay. Tell the prodigal boy, tell him to come. We are calling out from sin. Calling out from sin.
Calling out from sin. City of God.
right. Thank you so much, more family from the Golden Grove Church, for that video tribute. Interestingly, Sister Audrey Moore mentions that Pastor Lewis, in passing the animals in the countryside as he drove by, would greet them. I don't know how truthful that is, but I, knowing him, it's not far-fetched. Kirk Grant says, true words for a gentle soul who touched so many lives, always very fatherly, greeted me always with a scripture, took me under his wings, gave me the right hand of fellowship with Pastor D. Bell. More family. Thanking God for Pastor Lewis, he was everything to us at Golden Grove, as we have heard spoken by everyone. However, we at Golden Grove will never forget the children's treats, the family fun days. He was a lover of cricket. Our fun day had to have cricket. Carlton Moncrief Bunny was an excellent bowler at the time. As he ran up to bowl a ball to Pastor Lewis, he stopped him and said, Carlton, please take your time, son. Remember, I am your pastor. We used to admire his administration at convention. He would ensure and check up on us as young people that we were okay. When he was through with each of us, we realized that none of us were his favorite. We have been in meetings and experienced his mediation skills. Isn't it interesting how Pastor Lewis would make you all feel special in your own unique way? Dave Brown says, sending our deepest condolences to the Lewis's family and the church family on a whole. My memory of Pastor Lewis goes way back to the early 60s as a youth at the church in Darling Spring. I knew him as a magnet that held our attention. I remember in his preaching, he would always be demonstrating either with a chair, a cushion, or a book to explain his sermon, making it easy to understand. I grew up loving Pastor Lewis for his charismatic personality. He was inspiring, kind, and a true servant of the Lord. He was a people's person, which made him easy to love. My last memory of him delivering the word was at one of the convention under the tent at Spanish Town. I remember that one. That was 2001, if I am not mistaken. Summer of 2001 at Ebenezer. I was privileged to visit him while he was retired, and this was a day filled with encouragement and history of his ministry. I further visited him just before COVID. It was a great thing to have been able to spend this time with him. May his soul rest in peace until he rise to be with the Lord in glory. Sister Pam says, Pastor Lewis will never be forgotten. A very loving and kind-hearted man of God. I will surely miss his wise counsel. All right, thank you all for those tributes. We'll continue to share some more of those. I'm going to ask Carl Francis and Pastor Carl Francis and Lady Charmaine Francis to share in their tributes now, if they are ready.
Thank you very much, Brother Sanjay. Mm-hmm. I'm going to ask my wife to go first.
Do I think she'll be coming on your phone, or she's on her own device?
She's on her own device. She should be coming.
No problem. Sister Francis, you may go ahead. You can unmute. All right. Just unmute again, Sister Sharon.
I'm not sure if you're hearing me.
Hearing you loud and clear.
All right. Good night, everyone. To God be the glory. Great things he had done. I honestly don't even know where to start. But as it says, when you're starting something, you start from the beginning. And that's where I'm going to start. I sat here and I really enjoyed all the tributes that have gone out to Pastor Lewis. And I must concur with actually 95% of all the persons who have spoken. Now I listen to the Moors, and that really brings back memory to me. Those songs bring back memory. While we were coming from church this evening, my husband was was playing this one, The Leaves Never Fade, that one. And I said that Pastor Lewis that song is a favorite of his. And Come Walk With Me. And for the persons who knew him would have known that there is no crusade that is going to be ended without him singing that song. And this afternoon, I am happy that I'm able to share in this grand occasion, in that I can remember from way back then, Pastor Lewis baptized me as a little girl on the 25th of November, 1979. And from then, he has been a real role model to me. He has been a father figure. He has been a true friend. He has been a confidant. I heard somebody say that personal matters were shared with Pastor Lewis, just like myself. I have personal things that I've shared with him. And the counsel that was given to me was wise counsel. And I remember he called me Charm. That's the name he called me. And that name, when that name is called, it gives me a sense of belonging. I felt very, very close to him, having heard him calling me Charm. And as a little girl growing up at Golden Grove, we would always look forward to see Stella rolling in. And when we see Stella down by the gate, it's like we said, our skin catch a fire, because we know that Pastor Lewis is here. Pastor Lewis is here. That deep sense of honor has been meted out to him. And so this afternoon, I am very happy that I am able to share in this grand occasion. And I really miss him, because as a little girl growing up in the country, he has taught me a lot. He taught me how it is to fast and to pray as a teenager, and to follow those that follow the Lord. And so this afternoon, my heart is really grieving. You know why? I have never gotten a chance to see Pastor Lewis after leaving Jamaica. I plan that I would come to visit him, but then the COVID stepped in and I didn't get a chance to come. And so I am really saddened that I have not seen him over those many years. But I know that he's resting in peace with the Lord. And this afternoon, I just want to say condolences to Sister Lewis. I haven't seen her for years either, but I'm always inquiring about the family. And Michael and Nigel, and somebody asked me the other day if Michael is up there. I said, yes, Michael is up there long ago. And so I just want to say condolences to the Lewis's family. And I really, really miss Pastor Lewis. I was saying to somebody, even if I had gotten a chance to come and see him lying down on his bed, not even have the chance to say Charm, I would feel a little better that I have gotten the opportunity to look at him and to see him. And this afternoon, I just want to say thanks for the opportunity again that we were able to join in the celebration. And I know that the Lord is allowing his soul to rest in peace. When you have people like Pastor Lewis who has passed, the only thing we can say that is just celebrate his life. We're not going to mourn. Not really mourning. We are celebrating a life that is lived in a very good way. And all the persons who have shared their thought, I really concur with them. And I just want to say thanks again for this opportunity, and may the Lord continue to bless us richly. In Jesus' name, amen.
All right, let me use this opportunity to say thanks to the executive board and all the others who have made this possible. I am really so grateful. Even though I'm left here with a broken heart, I remember that 2020, I took my leave from the Bank of Jamaica. I make sure I saved that, and I said I want to be going to New York just to look for Pastor Lewis. And just when the time came, I'm about to go, then it was COVID. And I heard where he was, and that nobody, then we couldn't travel any at all. And I did say, all right, I'm going to be waiting until that pass, and I hope and pray that you'll be there so I can go and see him. I heard that you have been asking for me, and I really want to make it. The other day, I have to come out down here. She came down here. And I said, come out. I'm coming up very shortly to go and visit Pastor Lewis. And I get that shocking news. I must say to you that that man, he had left so much on me. I heard some persons comment sometimes that I have qualities of Pastor Lewis, and that let me feel fearful because I said, no man, I can't even step near that man's shoes, much more to walk in it. And you know, when I go around the places like he usually be, because right now I happen to pastor two of the churches that he used to pastor, and I notice that people keep asking me for this pastor. Some of them can't, some of the older people can't even remember the name, but they can remember that he used to sing after and finished preaching. And I say, oh, that's Pastor Lewis. And many of these other persons who are persons who have been to other denominations, they are not members of the Church of God Seventh Day. And you would have heard these people saying some things about this man. It warms your heart when you listen to those persons saying good things about your pastor. And the conversation just continues. And it allows you to really behave yourself wisely. Because a person could make, I know even one lady right now, every time that I see this lady, she's saying, when you go to visit Pastor Lewis, just call my name to him and tell him I love him. And, you know, this is one of those ladies who belong to another denomination. And she never forgets. Quite recently, she asked me about him. I said, yes, I want to go up and see him. And that is something that's been happening all over the place. I would have heard some of them say, boy, Pastor Lewis have never passed and don't wave to us our tooties on or stop and say something. And, you know, that has such impact. There is this thing about Pastor Lewis. It's really one of the things that let me think, stop a while and say, oh, how did he do it? Most of the time, Pastor Lewis would really come to Darling Spring. I don't know if it's a secret, but if it's a secret, everybody is going to know. I know that Pastor Lewis had about 7 children. I never see that man work outside of doing church work. He worked so hard in church work. Never see him do anything else. Never have a job. But whenever he visited Darling Spring and come to greet me, he always squeezed me, and I don't believe it's a squeeze. Something is left in there. I don't know. We always find them little money. And it used to help me out so well as a little youth. Don't have anything. He just squeezed me and I leave something in there and give a smile. And I say, oh my God, can you just imagine? This was the only man I like to squeeze my hand. Because it's always something in there. And you know, I remember that when he have never ended the altar call, never ended the altar call, and this he used these words, is there anyone who'd like to give their life to the Lord, just show by your upraised hand? And that is something that he left, he planted that tree in me. Never preach the word unless you have a part in there that you reach out to some soul. Remember, he said that to me, because you don't know who there is coming want to really hear the words and touch to give their life to the Lord. And those words kept really lingering in my ears right around Pastor Lewis, wherever he goes. And he still, I still remember them. And I prayed for the family, prayed for Sister Lewis, and for Nigel and the other sons, and that you will really continue to, you know, keep the candle burning for a man like this, that everybody that he comes across can remember to say good things about him. And, you know, the thing is that if there are no lies, there are no makeup, you don't have to make up anything. I don't even have to write anything. There are so many things to be said, and I will not go into them, because many of you have already said some of the things. But I just want us, as believers, for those of us who he had baptized, remember the words. He had never done a baptism unless he said, lift your right hand and say after me, thy vows, O God,
are upon me unto death. Wherever we are right now, especially those of you who have been baptized by Pastor Louis, remember that you made a vow to worship Almighty God. And I think you'll be so well pleased if we remember that it's unto death. May soul rest in peace. And may I offer condolences to all the bereaved family and all the churches on behalf of the Darling Spring Church. We want to say that we love you, Pastor. And say to the family members, we thank God that the years in Top Mountain Church too, that he has served those churches. And even the Dunkel community, where it wasn't a church, but the people there love him and know him so well. They want to extend greetings and condolences to you as bereaved family members. Thanks. God bless you all.
Thank you so much, Pastor Francis, Sister Francis, for your remembrance. Just before I take Judith Smith with her tribute, in the chat, Sister Nadine Ricketts says, my condolence again to Sister Louis and her seven wonderful sons with whom I grew up in the church. Pastor Louis was such a kind and gentle soul who wasn't afraid to speak his truth. His messages were always impactful and altar call effective. Take heart, my friends, and Sister Louis. And as Pastor would say, until then, with joy, let's carry on. Until the day your eyes behold the city. Until the day God calls us home. I am Nadine Ricketts, who Pastor Louis called Maxwell. Oh, so there was a female Maxwell as well, I guess. All right. Jacqueline Reynolds, Pastor Louis was a true man of God and a father to everyone. I will always remember his infectious smile and giggle. I remember him encouraging the young people to always stay with God. He will be remembered fondly by my family and myself. My love and condolences to his wife, sons, and the church brethren. I'm gonna take Sister Judith Smith now at this time. Judith.
Hi, everyone.
Hello, you can go ahead.
Greetings, happy Sabbath, everyone. Greetings, my pastor, Pastor Nigel, and all the Lewis's family members, all the members of the BCC family, all the pastors and brethren from all over the world. Greetings in the name of Jesus. I just want to remember Pastor Lewis. I think it is fair to say that he was worshipped. I think we kind of worshipped him back home. Like, it was like a God coming to visit Jupen Church when he visited Jupen Church. He visited our church, he hosted our rallies. And this was when I was a child growing up back home. I remember my mom, we used to sell orange on the highway, Bogwalk Highway. And whenever Pastor Louis was coming by, my mom would make sure she cut a bunch of banana. She had oranges waiting for him to come. And if he's going in one direction, he'll let her know when he's coming back. And on his way back, she will present him with these things. And those were the things I remembered from Pastor Louis back home. I was privileged to have him as my pastor when I came to the United States and I got baptized there. And I remember two things that happened that Pastor Louis spoke to me about. I was engaged to get married and he was giving me some counsel, marital counseling. And I remember he said to me, Sister Nadine, do you think you can allow someone to steer this ship of yours that you have been steering all your life? And I was like, yes, Pastor. And that marriage didn't happen. okay? And I think that was one of the reasons, because I probably wouldn't allow anybody to steer the ship that I've always been steering for all these years. Another incident happened in church where I was upset with a sister, and I was sitting down waiting. Church was dismissed and people were going around shaking hands, and I was sitting waiting for the sister to come and shake my hand, and the sister didn't come, and pastor realized how upset I was, and he called me and he said, Sister Nadine, do you think you can forgive that sister? And I said, no, pastor. And he said, listen to me. You cannot forgive her, no, but the Christ that's within you will forgive her. You of yourself will not be able to forgive her, but the Christ that is within you will forgive her. And these are things that I've stayed with me throughout my time in BCC, and I thank God every single day for Pastor Lewis. He baptized my son, who is now in Japan, and he was one of those children that were baptized with a set of young people that that pastor baptized. And I must say, on behalf of my mother, Sister Ellis, who was a close friend of Pastor Lewis, she's in Jamaica right now, and myself, my son who's in Japan, Dean Roy, I would like to wish Sister Lewis and the bereaved family my condolences, and to let them know that my prayers are with them. Also, the members of the church is the church back home, and the members of the BCC, which was the last church you churched. I know you guys are hurting, but I pray and I hope that God would hold you so close to his heart that you could all feel his heartbeat. My prayers are with you all. Be blessed. Stay blessed. Have a blessed evening, everyone. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Sisters Judith, for sharing. I am going to ask Sister Winifred to give her tribute at this time. And so as we seek to wrap up this segment, just reminding you, if you desire to share, you can just do that by indicate now with the raise hand feature, and following which we'll be just providing an opportunity for the immediate family to share their own thoughts, and if they so desire, as we seek to wrap up this segment. All right, so Sister Thompson, your time.
Good evening, everyone. Praise the Lord. This is Winifred Thompson. I'm a member of the Brooklyn Community Church of God, Seventh Day. Pastor Lewis was a man of God. Death to him is gain, equally so all believers. The life of Pastor Lewis is a part of the Church of God history. He's a thinker, an orator, a worker, a man of high principle, and a man of tender feelings. His religious character publicly and personally. It is a great event when such a man as pastor dies, when a man sagacious to plan, wise to impart counsel, vigorous to execute great design, is withdrawn from the earth, when lips once eloquent in the cause of truth become silent, when he who guided the young, warned the wicked, strengthened the feeble, comforted the sorrowful, animated the desponding, is seen no more. When he who brought the riches of his experience and the maturity of his judgment to aid the great interests of the truth and humanity has passed away, the world has no wealth to be compared with this great man, that all he does is employed in the cause of righteousness. I do hope in this dispensation, we can be blessed with more people like Pastor Lewis. May his soul rest in peace. I gave my condolence to the Lewis family and the relatives and all the brethren at 2603 Church Avenue. Again, I say accept our dearest sympathy. And again, may his soul rest in peace. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Sister Thompson. Sister Pam, I'm going to take your tribute in a bit. Just highlighting one in the chat from Donna Sherwood to the Lewis family. Kindly accept sincere condolences from the Sherwood's family, especially missionary Valerie Sherwood. Pastor Stanford Lewis was a very special man. His legacy will never be erased. Shalom. So, yes. My condolences to Sister Lewis, Pastor Nigel and family from Mother Carmen Williams and family. And from Marcia Gooden, sincere condolences to the Lewis's family. I have fond memories of Pastor Lewis. He took very good care of me when I just got saved. I was experiencing economic difficulty. He would squeeze my hands and leave something there. While I was in college, he increased his care of me as his visits to campus were regular, taking things from the country from my husband. I really experienced his love and care. All right, so many persons would have experienced a little hand squeezing from Pastor Lewis. Let's have Sister Pam know at this time.
Good evening, everyone. And blessings on you all. Yeah, I'm telling more from Ailes from Golden Grove, the root of Pastor Lewis's church building and setting up and foundation member and everything. You know, we used to Pastor Lewis coming and going. And listen, I'm not going to be staying long because everything that everybody has said before, I endorse that. It's very true of him. What more can we say? A man of God, stalwart man of God, humble, kind, loving, peaceful, praise God. And it's a really sudden time to see he left at the same. We could have kept him forever. We would have, but he's gone on to be with the Lord. What better can that be? And I praise God for his life that he lived. Everybody talks of his goodness. I'm going to tell you just a few little things about some of the rough times with him. I remember when he comes up and when I think his Pastor Brown mentioned when he started a meeting Sunday night. When you hear, come back Monday night, Tuesday night, and for like 3-4 weeks that meeting went. And after that, you know what? He had to go out into the villages and have meetings. Because I remember clearly sometimes we go to some places called Jubilee. I remember those places up there, Cedar, what do you call them again?
Cedar Valley.
Yes. And those places in the dark night. And he had to park Stella over here. And we walked it by foot because the roads are so bad. And he preached and we go for nights upon nights following in those rocks. So the only thing that we get comfort from is that during mango times, we walk with our bags and we get bags of mangoes and come home. And after he came home, those hours he drives still and he goes back home and he comes back again. And all those times he goes to rock and mountains and preached. And people used to stand up and listen to him. And many people sometimes used to come to the altar. Many refuse to surrender their lives, but they always stand by. If they're passing, coming from work, coming from wherever, they always stop by and listen to his preachings. Even down in our vicinities in Dry River, we recall it, and we keep meeting. You know, we have some men there, they drink and they drunk and they used to drunk. But as pastors start come by, everybody stand up straight. Nobody staggering again and laying down on the road. Everybody stopped by to listen to his preaching. So those are some of the things to add to what other people say. And I want to talk about sometime on one of his messages that really got to me sometime when he preached. He always preached this verse. And now the axe is laid to the root of the tree. Where the tree falls, there shall it lie. And sometimes, oh God, that got to me. Praise God, that really got to me sometimes. And, you know, those words stuck in me all the time. So I had to surrender my life to the Lord. And he always encourages and he always counsels, give good counsels. And sometimes when you are sad, and he say, he always call everybody my daughter or my son. Daughter, what's wrong now? And yes, yes, you can tell him your deep, dark secret, because only him and God knows. He's not going to tell it to anybody. So the love that I have for Pastor Lewis, ask Sister Lewis about it. We always quarrel over Pastor Lewis. And so that I have for him, that man is a man, a truly man of God. And I just hope that everyone else could, you know, emulate his style. One of his style of preaching that I always admired him when he comes to the end of his preachings also, he held out his hand. You know, people used to say, why are you calling little children to the altar? He held out his hand and he said, all of these, he asked all the children to stand and come to us. And he held out his hand and he said, all those who think that they're ready to accept the Lord, put your hand in mine. And the children would just come up and put their hand in Pastor Lewis's hand. And he held them and he said, yes, my daughter, God bless you. Yes, my daughter, God bless you. Yes, my son, God bless you. And I'm telling you, that really stick out to us. So in Harding, I just said, may the Lord continue to bless the family that led to take the example. Learn from him through the power of the Holy Spirit. And what is being said by of Pastor Lewis tonight might be said of all of us going forward. May God bless us all as we wait the final day when we shall all meet together in that heavenly kingdom. God bless.
Thank you so much, Sister Pam, for your tribute. And I do recall that last sermon I would have heard him preach in Jamaica, the 10th in Spanish Town. And as Sister Pam mentioned, his appeal to children, when he appealed to the children to come to the altar, and there, and he commissioned the newly appointed ministers to go for the children. It was just an interesting sight, as you saw. Children who were not yet saved go to the altar and commit their lives to the Lord. And we just give God thanks for the life he lived and that he was able to impact so many of us. And from that, from him impacting us, we have been able to impact others. So many online are ministers in different ways, and even those without titles still serving God and impacting others. And the prayer, as Sister Pam prayed, is that we will emulate him in many of these ways to continue to impact others for the building of Christ's kingdom. So again, to Sister Bloss, that name is going to keep, I'm going to keep that name now, Sister Phyllis, Sister Lewis, to Michael, Dean, Newville, Nigel, Maxwell, Kevin, Danon, our prayers are with you. And just praying God's strength, and importantly that he will keep you steadfast in him and strengthen your souls in him, that in the end we will all rise with our Maker and King to life eternal. I'm going to invite a member of the family, just or two or so, if you so desire, to share you. Giving you that opportunity now, you can indicate who I should unmute with the raise hand feature. I'll seek to unmute you. Pastor Gordon, if you are on, I'm gonna ask you to make a prayer at the end. If you can just indicate, let me see that you are on and hearing me. So from the Lewis's family, just confirming who is on and available. All right, Sir Nigel. So Nigel, what was your nickname? I didn't have a nickname, really. Yes, I was just, I don't know, I was just special.
It will still come up, you know. I'm just making the way for it to come up. You see?
That's fine. That's fine. I'm not gonna help you though. I'm not gonna help you. I just want to say on behalf of the family, thank you so much, Brother Sanjay, Cousin Sanjay, and the Pastor Harley, the executive board of the Jamaica Conference for, oh my gosh.
It's coming.
Oh my gosh. You know what? We're trying to maintain decor here, okay? So let's not, can you delete what's in the chat, Brother Sanjay?
No, I don't have that authority, sorry.
All right, Pastor Harley, the executive board of the Jamaica Conference, so many others who've spoken that, you know, I really can't call names, but everyone that gave tribute to Dad, we really appreciate it as a family, this outpouring of support that that you've shown, that the church has shown, the Jamaica Conference and folks around the world have shown. It really is, you know, very encouraging to us to know that, you know, so many people share in our loss and share in our hope as well, that his life is hidden in Christ. And just as we know he didn't live in vain, we also know that he didn't die in vain either. So thank you all so much for participating and for supporting us in this service, and even as we continue on to next weekend's going home service. You know, it's because of Dad that I have met so many wonderful people, and had the experience of relating with so many mothers and fathers in the church, people who, because of him and my mother, took us under their wings and became advisors to us and counselors to us and people who've cared for us. So much so that when my parents left Jamaica and we were there, there were so many people who came to let me know that, hey, look, you're not on your own. You still have people to answer to here. And Dad's life really speaks for itself. And everybody here said so much that it's truly, you know, an honest representation of his life and ministry and impact. And even as we talk about influence, Daddy lived as if he had no idea of the kind of influence he had. He was such a humble person. I've said to folks that Dad is the best man that I know, you know, within the context of humanity, obviously. But he's the best man that I know. And as a family, you know, we have such fond memories of him. I remember, as you talk about his visits, his trips into the country, I remember as a child sitting by the front window late in the night, in the early hours of the morning, just looking out for when Stella burst the corner so that I could run out and open the gate, because at that time of the night, you know, you don't want him coming out, open the car, open the gate, drive in, close the gate, that kind of thing. And so we know that we shared him. We know we shared him with the church. And to us, it was normal. And that is a testimony of the kind of father that he was, that we didn't feel any way like we were less loved, but we were so aware of his service and ministry in the church. And we appreciate him, and we appreciate you and all the kind words, thoughtful words that you've shared from every family, from every community. Some of those that really kind of stick out is the Golden Grove Church, the Top Mountain Church, all the churches in St. Catherine, all over the place. You know, it's really wonderful to hear from everybody this evening. So thank you again. You know, just remember what Dad said, believe half of what you see, none of what you hear. I don't know if you remember that tonight.
Also, another thing that he always used to say is, my son, if sinners entice thee, consent thou not. So many words of wisdom. And thank you so much for reminding us of them tonight. Thank you for sharing your experiences with him. You know, it's become so clear to us how rich a life he lived and how giving he was as a person and how many of you contributed to that. Many of you, you might not have known this, or maybe you didn't know this, but his ability to give really, really was a reflection of your giving to him. The things he shared, the ground provisions he shared that he distributed from his car as if it were a supermarket, but free of cost. Those things came from you, from many of you. So you all participated in some way in his ministry. And thank you so much again tonight to the conference, Jamaica Conference of Church of God, Seventh-day Pastor Harley and the team and all those who are supporting. Thanks again for turning up tonight. Really appreciate that. Before I go though, I just one thing, as everybody's talking so much about Stella, my memory of Stella is, you know, very, very sad. Very, very sad. Would you know, so when Dad left Jamaica, you know who got Stella, right?
I got Stella. Tell us about it. You got it?
I got Stella, okay? Do you know 1 week later, Stella kicked the bucket? I did not even get a chance to drive Stella, to cruise with Stella, you know, on a road. She served her time, and you know, we thank God for everything that, you know, that Dad was able to do with the limited resources that he had to bless so many people. Thank you all again, and good night. Thank you, Brother Sandy.
All right, thank you.
On behalf of the family, and thank you all for just everything you've said. We appreciate you, really appreciate every word of support and that you've shared with us as a family.
All right, thank you much, Brother Nigel. I wonder though if that death was investigated, you know, because it could have been natural causes or somebody deliberately took Stella's life. All right, but yes, oh boy, Stella was known in this conference, man, indeed. We really appreciate just the opportunity tonight to share. And even tonight, as you know, made me think, Pastor Harley and others, how many ministers, as in titled ministers, were baptized by Pastor Harley, by Pastor Lewis. So many, based on just tonight and hearing the discourse, and so many have been impacted by his service, the service that he gave from a heart that was just pure and sincere. And in such a humble way, we do give God thanks. We give God thanks for his life. I see Sister Pam suggesting, we're not going to to impute motive or anything, Sister Pam, but it seems suspicious, and we probably need to have an inquiry. Oh boy, there needs to be an inquiry. All right, Pastor Gordon, if you are on, I'm just going to invite you now to, oh, Kevin is going to share as well. Let me have Kevin share. And if there's any other family member who wishes to share, you can also indicate. Go ahead, Kevin.
So can you hear me?
Yes, hearing you clearly.
So I just want to say, I was just thinking about this. The time that we would come to remember Daddy, there was a long time before that.
Mm-hmm.
And it was a real pleasure tonight for you to fill in that gap, for everybody here that loved him, appreciated him, respected him, filled in that gap, you know. And we just want to say, I want to say thank you, because you know, I hear people say, you know, he wonder how he dealt with the family or how the family dealt with him not being there. And I got to tell you, it didn't seem like he wasn't there. You know, he was always supportive. Anything he could do for any one of his sons, he was there and he did it. So thank you all for loving him with us. And, you know, I said to myself that he didn't have seven children. Because as everybody said, everybody was a family member to him. Whether son, daughter, he was a husband to the father, to the wife, or husbandless. He filled so many shoes, you know. And I'm not familiar with that pastor that said that, you know, he had some traits and he didn't want to go near those shoes. It's something that we ponder every day, like as his children. I don't think anybody could fill those shoes. We could try, but he was just built that way. God molded him into who he was, and I don't think there'll ever be another Pastor Lewis. So again, thank you everybody for all the love that you gave to him over the years. He never felt alone. As I tell Sister Shara, anybody that he came in contact with, he genuinely loved and cared for you. There was never a mistake or thought about that. So thank you everybody again. Good night.
Thank you for sharing, Brother Kevin, sharing your thoughts and appreciation. Thank you so much. All right, just giving a final opportunity. If there's another member of the family who wishes to share, you can indicate, following which we will have a closing prayer being made. All right, so. Let me just confirm with Pastor Gordon, if you're on, you can unmute. All right, if not, all right. So let me take just this hand I've seen, and then I'm gonna ask Pastor Harley to make that closing prayer. That's Christine Claire. You can go ahead and then we'll have Pastor Harley. You can unmute Christine Claire. All right. We're trying to unmute you. You'll have to unmute.
Good night. My aunt, she's at Samson's SM. That's Mr. Lewis's younger sister, would like to say something.
Oh, thank you so much. No problem. She'll have to unmute though. Okay, good.
I tried to unmute.
I understand. You can go ahead now.
Okay. Are you hearing me?
Yes, we're hearing you clearly.
Yes, I am Loris. I am Brother Lewis's younger sister. We have been close for all of these years. I was not about to say anything because I'm disrobed, but it's okay. That's he fine. Has been a precious soul from the day we went to school. He has been a guardian of the classes he was in. He was my cohort. He guarded me from all the bullies. We are just 3 years apart. And he looked out for me in every special way. And even when his ministry was in Kingston, we used to meet. And I can say that I'm very proud of what he has done, the lives he has touched, and I am very proud of the family he has raised. And I am sure that wherever he is at this moment, his heart is at joy hearing all that you people have said. But I would like to say, he raised me up so I can stand on mountain. He raised me up to walk on stormy seas. And when I was down, he placed me on his shoulder and raised me up to more than I can be. And for that, I'm grateful that he was my older brother. And I'm grateful for the treasures we served and saved together. He was a special little boy from the day of kindergarten. God had prepared him for the work that all you people have enjoyed now. And may his soul rest in peace and light perpetually shine on him. I'm in touch with his immediate family, and I used to talk to him daily at the nursing home, and he looked forward to it and my prayers. And for that, I'm very satisfied. May God bless you all, and may you continue the work that he has left behind. Good night, and God bless.
Thank you so much. How could you have us close without hearing that? Much appreciated. Thank you. Over to you, Pastor. Pastor Harley.
Shall we pray? O God, our help in ages past, our hope for years to come, our shelter from the stormy blast and our eternal home, under the shadows of your wing, your saints have dwelt secure. Sufficient is thine arm alone, and our defense is sure. We honor you tonight, O God, and bless your holy and majestic name. We admit before you that we are frail, feeble human beings, that you are sovereign, omnipotent, immortal, invisible, only wise, and that as men we are limited, O God, in our ability to adequately express even our appreciation, let alone the wonders of your grace and your mercy. And so tonight, with many others gathered from far and near, we reflect on the life of your servant, departed Pastor Stanford Lewis. And O God, our hearts are indicting a good matter. And we're thankful that we can do it with the family members. O God, we thank you that you made him of such material that he was able to give so much to all of us. Hallelujah. And yet to have him serve in such a way that he seemed not to have neglected anything. And we are grateful, O God, that you supplied him with the grace and more grace as he ministered. So many of us, O God, have testified of the impact and the words, lives of great men all remind us. We can make our lives sublime and departing leave behind us footprints on the sands of time. Tonight, the footprints on the sands of time are very clear. Pastor Stanford Lewis has left them. And oh God, many of us have walked in them, are walking in them. And from the testimonies, generations will walk in those footsteps. We thank you for having carried him along and enabled him that he could have been such a blessing. And now you have called him home, O God. We thank you that all is well that's done by you. Hallelujah. And you who gave him to us and called him home, you're able to raise him up again. Blessed be your holy name. Hallelujah. And so we pray, O God, that for him, He'll be called in the first resurrection. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. To receive his reward. We pray tonight for the family, O God, and the gap that is left by the loss of a loved one. And in spite of the challenges there may have been in life, the loss leaves a vacancy that nothing can fill. But we are thankful for the memories, wonderful memories, precious memories, hallelujah, that can provide us with a kind of hope and motivation as we go on. And so, Lord, we thank you and bless you and pray now for the comfort of the family. And I pray in the name of Jesus Christ that all the children, hallelujah, all the boys of Pastor Stanford Lewis will recognize what a blessing it is and has been to have had a father who shared himself and witnessed so much and believed so much in the plan of salvation that they will find it as the path to walk and that they will look forward to being reunited with their father, walking in the footsteps of the master as their father seemed to have done. I pray for Sister Lewis, his wife, oh God, of many years, who has been faithful and who has served and had been a source of real comfort and support over the many, many years. Thank you for the mother she has been to her children. Thank you for the woman she has been in the church of God. Hallelujah. And I pray, oh God, for her strength and that her faith in you will remain firm to the end. Thank you for the church where Pastor served and his son now served. Pray, God, that the ministry will grow and reflections on his life will serve as a motivation and a planting of seeds that will redound to a great harvest. On behalf of all of us, O God, who gather tonight, we say thank you for the privilege you have given us to be able to share in these moments. And we pray now, God, that you will dismiss us with your richest blessings. And as future celebrations and future activities and ceremonies may accompany the final rites of Pastor Lewis's time on earth and his body, we pray that your Holy Spirit will be there to bless, to guide, and to do good. We ask you these mercies, O God, and pray that whatever we are inadequate in asking for and we stand in need of, that you will supply it according to your riches glory, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Thank you, Pastor Harley, for prayer. We're sharing at this time details regarding the memorial service and burial for Pastor Lewis. The memorial service will be held Sunday, September 11th at Guarino Funeral Home. And there'll be a repast at the American Legion Memorial Hall. Please note the Zoom meeting ID 810-6346-9216. That's 810-6346-8216. So for those who are not able to attend in person, you can share and participate via the Zoom meeting ID. The burial will be on Monday, September 12th at the Pine Lawn Memorial property. So that's the 11th for the memorial service and the 12th for the burial. All right. All right, so let me just repeat the number. I think I may have said something incorrectly. So the meeting ID is 810-6346-9216. That's 610-6346-9216. So one last time, and you can type it in the chat for me, please. Thank you.
That's 810-6346-9216. And I gather Pastor Gordon was trying to unmute. I thought I had activated that. So sorry about that, Pastor Gordon. But let me make sure. Right. So thank you, one and all. I'll allow him then just to express thanks on behalf of the exec board. Then Pastor Gordon, I'll save the thanks for you to do. I'm trying to unmute you now. All right, let me make you co-host. Pastor G, you can try to unmute, please. All right. So we're having some difficulty there, Pastor G. All right, well, thank you one and all for sharing those precious memories of Pastor Stanford Lewis. Much appreciated, and just take us out with that song, Precious Memories. And again, you can use the chat just to indicate you are here, so at least family members can see. Sometimes the name you come under on the device, it's not recognized, but at least type it in the chat. Father, loving